Sergeants, will you please start your recordings?
PC recording has started.
Thank you.
Cloud recording started.
Thank you.
Backup is rolling.
Thank you. Sergeant Polite, you may begin with your opening statement.
Thank you. Good afternoon, and welcome to the remote hearing on immigration, jointly with the Committee on Government Operations. Will council members and staff please turn on their videos at this time? Once again, will council members and staff please turn on their video at this time? Thank you. To minimize disruptions, please place all cell phones electronics to vibrate. You may send your testimony at testimony@council.nyc.gov. Once again, that's testimony@council.nyc.gov. Chair, we are ready to begin.
Thank you, Sergeant Polite. And buenas tardes, everyone. We're going to have a really important and timely hearing. I call this hearing to order, and I'd like to introduce myself to you. My name is Carlos Menchaca, and I'm the chair of the New York City's Council Committee on Immigration. Today, the Committee on Immigration is joined by the Committee on Governmental Operations, and my colleague, Chair Fernando Cabrera, and I will conduct this oversight on the city's language access and emergency preparedness. I'd like to recognize members of the council that are here with us today, Councilmember Drum, Kalos, Mazel, Perkins, Powers, and Yeager. In the city that never sleeps, New Yorkers speak over 200 different languages. While one in four New Yorkers is limited English proficient, or LEP, the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs reports that close to half of all immigrant New Yorkers are LEP. The ability to communicate in English can be an enormous barrier for LEP communities when it comes to accessing critical city services and information. Recognizing this, in 2017, the council sought to ensure that the city spoke the languages of its residents. Local Law 30 of 2017 required that the city provide language assistance for speakers of the top 10 citywide designated languages. According to the mayor's office, that list encompasses Spanish, Chinese, Russian, Haitian Creole, Korean, and the newly added Arabic, Urdu, French, and Polish. And in their most recent annual report, MOIA states that 85% of all LEP New Yorkers speak one of those 10 languages. In 2018, the committee held a hearing to review the city's compliance with Local Law 30, specifically taking a deep dive into city agency language access plans, which should clearly set out an agency language access in priorities. 2 years later, and only a handful of agencies have made the changes to their language access plans that we highlighted at that hearing. Moreover, most agencies have not reported on their annual language access efforts, and many have not published updated plans since 2018. I expect to hear commitments today from the administration that these reports and updated plans will not be delayed further. Today, the city is in the midst of a second wave of COVID-19 cases, a pandemic of such unimaginable scale just a year ago. One of the ways the language access law anticipated 2020 was that it required that all agencies include emergency preparedness sections in their language access plans. The New York City that we know is no stranger to disaster, and the architects of this legislation wanted to ensure that when a disaster came, the city was prepared to communicate with and support all its residents, not only those who could read, write, and speak English. Today, the committees will be taking a deep dive yet again, this time focusing on the emergency preparedness that COVID-19 responsive, city agencies included in their mandated language access plans, and how the city managed their mandate of proper and timely language access during the pandemic. As we begin this hearing, I would like us to imagine what it feels like to be an LEP New Yorker, perhaps an immigrant LEP New Yorker or an undocumented LEP New Yorker. Imagine being the parent of a child who is expected to engage in virtual learning when your child's school has offered no support for your language. How to navigate that? How to engage, who to ask, who who do you ask for questions? Imagine receiving delayed mixed messages from your government about avoiding medical services so that you can stay home even though you should be seeking medical help. Imagine the trauma and the frustration of losing family members to COVID-19 and not being able to make a burial plan for your loved ones because you could not communicate with privately run funeral homes. Imagine trying to navigate various government agencies regarding sending the body of a loved one to their nation of origin as a non-English speaker. Imagine being gravely ill with COVID-19 and being unable to communicate with healthcare workers, trying their best to provide you healthcare in an overburdened system that does not adequately provide language access. Just last week, the NYCEM sent out notifications about school closures in Spanish, stating that the schools would be closed a partir del XX de noviembre. This is unacceptable. The city should not have done this, and they need to do better. The city must do better. And linguistic diversity is not new to the city, and this pandemic has only heightened all of the ways in which the city should be doing better and speaking to its residents, communicating to its residents in their language. I want to thank Chair Cabrera again, as well as the Committee on Governmental Operations for joining us in our hearing today, as well as all the staff behind the scenes making this hearing run smoothly and ensuring that we are all prepared for this conversation. I'd like to thank Immigration Committee staff for their hard work on this issue, Committee Counsel Harbani Ahuja, Policy Analyst Elizabeth Kronk, Government Operations Committee staff will be thanked by our chair. And with that, I want to turn it over to Co-Chair Cabrera. Chair Cabrera, are you ready?
Thank you so much. Good afternoon. Thank you to my co-chair, Councilmember Carlos Menchaca, for inviting my committee to join today and your leadership on this important issue, one that I know full well, though I was born right here in the Bronx. My first language was Spanish. My parents moved to Puerto Rico. I know the pressures, I know the insecurities, the fears, especially what young people go through and families. And I want to thank the sponsors of the bills we will be hearing today, Councilmember Carnegie Jr. for joining us today and for your leadership on this issue. And Councilmember Fernando Cabrera, as he was stated, Chair of the Committee on Governmental Operations. Today, we are holding our second oversight hearing on the city's landmark language access law, Local Law 30 of 2017. During the Bloomberg administration, there was an executive order on language access that required agencies to provide public services in six languages. Local Law 30 codified and expanded upon that order. We increased the number of languages to 10, mandated certain good practices and require regular outreach to language communities outside the 10 designated languages. Every covered agency is required to develop a language access implementation plan and report on their progress annually. We conducted our first oversight hearing on those plans back in October 2018. We're happy to see that a good level of compliance with our law, but it also found a lot of room for improvement. Today, we are focusing on our second review of agencies' plans on how they provide language access in times of emergency, just like we have just experienced during the COVID-19 pandemic. You heard it from Councilmember Menchaca, and I will say it again, ensuring language access in all 10 city languages, especially during times of emergency, must be a number one priority of city agency. Staying informed on quickly changing public health rules and guidance is literally a matter of life and death for all New Yorkers today. Knowing how to keep assessing city services as agencies adjust to remote work is a matter of life and death. And those who rely upon it in their daily lives. We must ensure that our immigrant neighbors and those that are proficient in English have equal access to information services in their language. I want to thank the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs and the Mayor's Office of Operations for their continued work to ensure agency are complying with Local Law 30. We are committed to working together to reach a successful implementation of this law by every covered agency. We are also hearing two bills today. The first, Introduction 63, sponsored by Councilmember Cornegie Jr., will require the Department of Consumers and Workers Protection and Health and Mental Hygiene to provide written communications regarding inspection results in the business owner's language of choice. Councilmember Cornegie is here today and will speak more on his bill. We're also hearing Introduction 1868, sponsored by Councilmember Torres. This bill will establish an Office of Puerto Rico, New York City Affairs with a director appointed by the mayor. The office will be empowered to provide assistance to former residents of Puerto Rico and descendants of Puerto Rico residents, including addressing the needs of people displaced from Puerto Rico, assisting in obtaining vital documents from Puerto Rico, assisting in understanding and applying for government programs, making referrals to nonprofits, and providing any other services the director deems necessary to provide. The director will need to make reasonable efforts to work with the government of Puerto Rico to provide these services. Thank you to my colleagues joining here today's hearing and many other staff working behind the scene to ensure this remote hearing runs smoothly. I want to also thank my committee staff. I call on the Dream Team for their work on this issue. Committee Counsel CJ Murray, Senior Policy Analyst Emily Forjon, and Elizabeth Krong, Senior Finance Analyst Sebastian Bacci, and my Communication Legislative Director Claire McLevin. And I will now turn it back to the moderator.
Thank you, Chair. And we are not yet joined by Councilmember Cornegie or Torres. So we will wait for them to join and give them the opportunity to speak on those bills. But at this point, let's hand it over to our moderator, Harbani Ahuja.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Harbani Ahuja, and I'm counsel to the Committee on Immigration at the New York City Council. Before we begin, I want to remind everyone that you will be on mute until you are called on to testify, when you will be unmuted by the host. I will be calling on panelists to testify. Please listen for your name to be called. I will be periodically announcing who the next panelists will be. For everyone testifying today, please note that there may be a few seconds of delay before you are unmuted, and we thank you in advance for your patience. All hearing participants should submit written testimony to testimony@council.nyc.gov. At today's hearing, the first panel will be an advocate panel, followed by the administration, followed by council member questions, and then the public will testify. During the hearing, if council members would like to ask a question, please use the Zoom raise hand function and I will call on you in order. I would like to note that council member Moya has joined for the record. And we will now turn to testimony from our first panel. I'd like to welcome Ravi Reddy to testify. After Ravi, we will be hearing from Aracelis Lucero, Robert Agimong, and then Theo Moore. Ravi Reddy, you may begin when you are ready.
Starting time.
I want to thank the Committee Chairman Chaka, Committee Chair Cabrera, and the Immigration and Governmental Operations Committees for holding this hearing and giving the Asian American Federation the opportunity to testify today. I'm Ravi Reddy, and I'm the Associate Director for Advocacy and Policy at the Asian American Federation. AAF represents a collective voice of more than 70 member nonprofits serving 1.3 million Asian New Yorkers. So for some context, this pandemic has resulted in a 35% increase in deaths compared to the five-year average. Our small businesses have been hit earlier and harder than the general economy, and rising anti-Asian xenophobia and violence is further isolating our most vulnerable out of fear for their safety. Over 1.3 million Asians live in our city, 16% of our city's total population. Overall, 14% live in poverty, including one in four Asian seniors, and almost half of our community has limited English proficiency. We want to thank these committees and the city agencies who continue to do the hard work of acting on persistent concerns of language access, but we're here because this hard work requires greater urgency. For example, 88% of our Asian small business owners are immigrants, but in this crisis, the lack of timely translation is exacerbating inequities between our small business owners and their English-speaking counterparts. Many Asian small businesses continue to be unable to apply for government assistance because in-language assistance and instructions never materialized, or they came too late. AAF has also heard reports from across the city of a lack of engagement during city inspections regarding what needs to be done if a small business owner does not speak English, who are simply forwarded to city websites. But city agency websites are extremely difficult to navigate for LEP small business owners in their own right, and language access issues are compounding difficulties our reeling small businesses are having in navigating complicated city bureaucracies. Language access is, at its core, an issue of relationship building. And our seniors, our most vulnerable population, are coming to our community service providers before they approach our city to get their basic needs met, because like most immigrants, they'll utilize services that reflect their values and ethnic identities. Language access is a function of cultural competence, and in so many ways, our community-based organizations are leveraging the goodwill they have earned in our communities to provide programming and conducting wellness checks in language, hand in hand with culturally competent food services and healthcare. When it comes to languages of limited diffusion, like Nepali or Punjabi, telephonic translation, the norm for mainstream and government service providers, has shown time after time that there are few substitutes for in-person translation. This is where our community-based organizations shine, demonstrating that they are best equipped to provide local, accessible, and culturally competent services, turning unreliable language access into meaningful and equal access to services for the city's newest residents. New York's Pan-Asian American community is made up of more than 20 ethnic groups, diverse in language, culture, and religion. And since 2017, AAF has worked in coalition with African Communities Together, MASA, and the New York Immigration Coalition to expand the number of languages covered by city social service agencies, and this work continues. Now, I just have a couple recommendations, if it's okay. So now we need city agent initiatives to allocate the funding needed to fully implement the new citywide languages covered by Local Law 30. And we need to amend contracting processes to allow Asian-led nonprofits to more accurately reflect the cultural and language expertise they bring when serving our community members. Many organizations we advocate on behalf of also must use their limited resources to find interpreters and translators who are not always trained in interpreting or translating legal, medical, and other sensitive terminology, or devote staff hours to these responsibilities. The city must provide better funding and support for CBOs who are already familiar with the matter, have community buy-in, and are asked to provide translations. We also believe in the work we've been doing over the past 3 years alongside our partners I mentioned before to create a language bank to expand translation services for as many immigrant communities as possible, and we ask the council to find ways to support this effort. And finally, we think the city must consider creating a mechanism for central uniform translation by city agencies. This is a question of access as much as it is a question of capacity. So with that said, we look forward to working with all of you and city agencies in this effort. Thank you.
Can I interject really quick here? Ravi, does the council have your digital version of this testimony?
I will be submitting a written testimony immediately after this, yes.
Okay, great. I want to get those recommendations.
Absolutely.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now call on Aracelis Lucero. You may begin when you are ready.
Starting time.
Thank you. Buenas tardes. My name is Araceli Zucero. I am the executive director of MASA. I'd like to first start by acknowledging Native American Heritage Month and also honor the Lenape people as we stand on what was once their home. Tlazo Kamati, which means thank you in Nahuatl, an indigenous language of Mexico, for inviting me today to share our testimony. MASA is a community-based organization that works with Mexican and Latin American immigrant children, youth, and families in the South Bronx to develop strong learners and leaders who fully contribute to their community. We have a community-led integrated model that engages the entire family, and we are grounded in a deep commitment to strengthening literacy, leadership, and power for Mexican, Central American, and Indigenous people. The community in which MASA has worked for over two decades is often considered hard to reach, largely undocumented, with 95% of the adults being foreign-born, 40% of the parents have less than a primary school education, and about 85% have less than a secondary school education. About 30% of our community members speak an indigenous language like Mixteco, Nahuatl, Tlapaneco, Mam, to name a few, and the majority have an annual income of $30,000 or less for an average family of 4.5. And I would like to know that that is data from before the pandemic, so we know that their household income has dramatically decreased. Many of our community members work in the food service, cleaning, childcare, and construction industry. About 90% of the families, as soon as the city went on pause, lost their income and their jobs. And so they currently are facing food, housing, education, and health insecurity. A significant number of MASA community members, especially amongst our indigenous speaking community, have limited digital literacy and limited literacy skills, which present their own set of challenges as we all seek to provide better support and services for this community who were severely impacted by the pandemic. This has to be something that is considered as we discuss improving language access for especially immigrant communities, since not everybody has the same level of access to digital literacy or literacy overall. And of course, we serve a community that is mostly limited English proficiency. And I'm just gonna focus on two particular areas that are really important to MASA. Education, as Carlos Menchaca has already noted, there was a lot of misinformation or lack of information flowing to families during the pandemic who did not speak English. School-based communications were coming to families without being translated. And very oftentimes they were getting translation of important documents much later than their English speaking counterparts. We have an understanding that there's a TNI unit in the Department of Education, but they've stated that they're really overstretched and taxed during this time, but that's simply like not okay, especially when we're not communicating health information and families need to make important decisions. I'll skip over to the health. I just want to talk about one instance that really impacted our organization and this community member. His name is Evaristo. He was renting a room. He was afraid to go to the emergency room. He was asked not to go by his roommates, who were also undocumented. He did not know how to read and write, spoke Mixteco. And when I called the city, the local city hospital, I have a good friend in the community affairs department who said that they would support him. However, that if they spoke an indigenous language, it was best if they brought somebody, especially if they did not know how to read and write. I think we need to do better. I'm just gonna go quickly through my recommendations and I'll submit the testimony, but we definitely would like to advocate for the language bank and language worker cooperatives, especially for the Latin American indigenous languages, especially because there's limited language and limited literacy and digital literacy. We feel is critically important, especially for this group and all limited language diffusion languages, to have access to interpreters that are trained and that are culturally responsive to their communities. We would like to propose to improve school-based communications and central DOE capacity. There was a plan that was submitted to the Department of Education that was created by the New York Immigration Education Collaborative that we would like to strongly advocate for. An increased number of health and mental health professionals, including counselors in schools that speak Spanish and or indigenous languages and who are culturally fluent. Again, I think something that we've heard a lot about today, language access goes hand in hand with being able to reach and gain the trust of community members. And then folding adult literacy initiatives that include digital literacy, adult literacy, and ESL classes for our community. I would like to end by saying that the true testament of who we are and our values are how we treat the most vulnerable members of our society. And I look forward to partnering with the city to make that happen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Next, we will be hearing from Robert Agyemong. You may begin when you are ready.
Starting time.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Chairman Menchaca and Chairman Cabrera. I really appreciate the opportunity to speak to you this day today about language access for African communities. And my name is Robert Agyemong. I am the New York Director for African Communities Together. African Communities Together, also known as ACT or ACT, is an organization of African immigrants that empowers our community members to integrate socially, advance economically, and engage civically. I'm representing our communities respectfully who were not really communicated properly to during this pandemic. And I want to emphasize that there has to be a more strategic way of how we communicate with the communities that are quote unquote hard to reach. Most COVID information, due to the nature of this pandemic, was rapid, it was instantaneous, and it was not in languages that was accessible to our communities. In response to this pandemic, ACT conducted a survey to measure the impact of COVID-19 and all of its impact in the African community. Between May and July, early July, ACT was able to conduct a survey of 1,041 community members. The results of this survey would give you an indication of how much work we still need to do. With the question that we asked, did you receive any information from the government about the coronavirus, either health information or resources like unemployment in your language? 55% said no, and another 5% said they were not sure. While from early July to late August, we kept tracking this question, but within a different kind of survey. When we asked an additional 435 community members, 90% said no to the same question of whether or not they received information in their language. If you combined those answers just from that short period of 3 months where the pandemic was at its most ravaging, we're looking at over 65% of African communities were not able to receive vital languages that were able to help them or get them information on how to save their lives or the lives of their loved ones. Only 35% was able to get this information. And I want to also emphasize that of that 435 between early July and late August that were... I just asked for a little bit more time just to make a couple more points. I do apologize. Of that 435, of the 90%, that 90% said they did not receive the information, over 50% of those community members spoke French. And so while we do emphasize French, French is still, there's still a long way to go with French and then also some of the other languages that we have. On behalf of ACT and MASA and the New York Immigration Coalition and the Asian American Federation, I would like to also recommend and continue to urge the council to invest in the creation of a community legal interpreter bank, which recruits, trains, and dispatches legal interpreters who provide services free of cost to city-funded nonprofit legal providers, and also the development of language services worker-owned cooperatives, which are community-based worker-owned agencies that build the pipeline of trained languages service professionals while creating skilled employment and business opportunities for New York immigrant communities. I thank you for your time. I look forward to working with all of you to create a greater New York.
Thank you, Robert.
Thank you for your testimony. Now we will hear from Theo Moore. You may begin when you are ready.
Starting time.
Good afternoon. My name is Theodore Moore. I'm the Director of Local Policy and Legislation at the New York Immigration Coalition, an umbrella policy and advocacy organization that works statewide with over 200 immigrant serving member organizations. Thank you, Chairman Chaka, Chair Cabrera, and the members of the City Council for hearing and allowing me to testify. On the topic of language access, New York City took a really important step with the passage of Language Access Policy Local Law 30. However, there's still a significant language barriers to language access for New York's immigrant communities, particularly those that speak languages of limited diffusion. And we saw and are continuing to see the effects of those barriers throughout this pandemic.
To build on the recent gains in this area, we continue to propose that the council support the creation of Community Legal Interpreter Bank, modeled after the one that has been used successfully since 2007 in DC to expand language access and increase the supply of trained, vetted immigration legal interpreters by committing funding through the city council budget to be provided to community-based organizations. To better serve LLDs, we are proposing that the funding for the New York City Council's Worker Cooperative Business Development Initiative be increased to enable immigrant community-based organizations to develop three and launch three language service worker-owned cooperatives, one for African languages, one for Asian languages, and one for indigenous Latinx American languages. The existence of both the CLIB and the cooperatives would have allowed for an additional resource for individuals, community organizations, and even the city government to rely on. While I can't claim to have known that we were going to endure a global pandemic this year, the New York Immigration Coalition, MASA, Asian American Federation, and African communities together have been trying to bring attention to these issues and offering these very same solutions for over 3 years now. We hope this time our warning will be heeded and our solutions will be implemented. Another issue with local law 30 that has been made obvious throughout this pandemic is that there is no allowance for adjustment of documents that are commonly distributed to the public that are translated for emergency purposes. And there is no specificity on timetable for when documents should be translated. There may need to be amendments or additions to local law 30 to mandate such adjustments and dictate the timeliness necessary for emergency situations. And while we're talking about, while we're focusing on solutions, we must not forget about our immigrant adult learners. 2.2 million people in New York City, one out of every three adults, are either lacking a high school diploma or have low English proficiency. In support of these adult learners, we call on the city council and the mayor in next year's budget to both restore all funding for adult literacy programs and invest additional money over the next 2 years to fund a pilot program that would provide wraparound services to adult learners and will lead to greater gains and a wider range of benefits for families and communities. Once again, thank you for convening this extremely important hearing and allowing me to testify. Myself, our entire organization, and the 140 New York NYC members across New York City look forward to continuing to work with all of you to come up with solutions to ensure that everyone enjoys a full and equal opportunity to recover from the threat of this virus and the worst potential economic downturn since the Great Depression. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. At this time, I'll see if any council members have questions for this panel. As a reminder, if you'd like to ask a question, please use the Zoom raise hand function and I will call on you in order. Chairman Chaka.
Thank you. Thank you, Arbani, and thank you to the panel for really laying the foundation of work that has been in progress for 3 years now. I guess my first question is, have you sat down with the administration, anyone at the administration, and reviewed some of these ideas with them? We can pick any one of you all, Theo or Robert.
Yeah, and ourselves, I feel like you were a part of these meetings too. Last year and the year before when we were going throughout the budget process, we did meet with members of MOIA, and they definitely seemed to be very attractive to, you know, like interested in both the language interpreter bank and the worker cooperative, more so I would say for the language interpreter bank. But we have had conversations and we'll continue those conversations to in hope of implementing these policies.
Is there any sense of what the hurdle is at the mayor's office on kind of pushing this forward?
Ourselves?
I think overall and for many people, there is a question of feasibility and scalability and also having a clear understanding of how the services work, right? So figuring out who has access, What kind of, you know, as a business, what kind of income strategies, you know, can be implemented in order for this to be scalable, timeline. And also, I think one thing that we've been honest, and I know for especially for Latin American indigenous languages, is that different communities might be in different starting points. And so this will take some time. But also it's like understanding the DC model and how it can be implemented. So I think that it's more of like the little nuance of how it would actually be operationalized that that I think may be some of the questions that some people may have, and then how to also you know, incorporate it into existing initiatives, for example, the small business initiatives. And so I think those have been some of the talking points.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And I think as someone that's in the city council and part of the budget negotiation team and chair of the immigration committee and part of the adult literacy coalition and just embedded in everything that you're all doing, the council is very aligned with what you're talking about. And I just want to confirm that the council has heard your voice. The council is thinking about pushing this. And for us, I think some of the hurdles have been about money. How do we fund this? And the execution is a different piece. That's where the mayor's office comes in coordination with all of you. But I think that's gonna be the question moving forward. This isn't a budget hearing. This is a place for us to go and review content and really understanding the impact to a project like this, but there's a lot of support in the council. Maybe my last question is about workforce, and having the workforce is kind of one piece that you all spoke about, really bringing people from the community that understand that indigenous language and just language, and really connecting them to a workforce opportunity, a job. Do you all think about this as a jobs plan as well? And can you talk a little bit about what that looks like for you all and for the city as we restart our economy?
I think I could go first. Absolutely. I think that has been one of the greatest pushes for this as immigrant serving organizations with with our community members having very limited options. Workforce opportunities for employment, especially during this time, I think we've seen an uptick in like street vending. A lot of our community members are looking for opportunities to get back on their feet. And so for me, quite frankly, it's like a non-brainer to be able to invest in this community who have like showed up as delivery workers, as construction workers, cleaning, taking care of our kids. And so being able to invest in their development, there is not a lack of interest. There's a lack of opportunities. And so I think that as a matter of business development and investing in like all vulnerable communities, and especially limited of language diffusion communities, is really, really important. They've been like not seen, not heard, and excluded, especially undocumented people from the traditional like opportunities to get back on their feet. That's what I would have to say.
Yeah, I would 100% agree. You know, we not only see this as a solution to language access issues, but also as a way to create jobs and entrepreneurship. So each one of these individuals in the cooperative are their own small business, and they are able, so the two things actually work together. So the members of the cooperative are then able to have their services go through the interpreter bank. So it's actually means to get them, you know, to actually be able to help along with their small businesses and the cooperative that they're building. And then I don't have to explain to you, you know, on the adult literacy side, individuals who go through those programs, especially individuals who don't have digital literacy, you know, how their earning potential just rises. So these are really things, you know, as we're seeing, you know, record unemployment throughout the city, especially in immigrant communities, could actually be a solution on the job front as well.
Yeah, I just want to add in, like, you know, this is in every way what community empowerment is supposed to be. It's building an industry in the community based on those individual community needs. Now, you know, I was mentioning how, you know, a lot of them have to work with the city or go through mainstream organizations that, you know, stick with, or have no choice beyond telephonic translation. So, you know, building these industries from the inside out and expanding, and not just making it such that these not just making it such that they just work within their community, but really giving these an industrial base in some sense of the word. I think the other argument is that where this idea actually makes more efficient the expenditure of city dollars. Right now, you're seeing a lot of nonprofits and a lot of agencies actually spending a lot of money just looking for translators. So in every sense of the word, this is really helping, reinforce these communities that have already been hit.
Thank you for that. I just wanted to lay that out, that we already have a lot of pieces of this. We have a robust adult literacy program that survived a lot of the budget cuts. We have a worker cooperative initiative that's funded by the council to really ensure that work cooperatives have what they need, legal assistance to be able to grow. We just need the funding and the leadership to really ensure that this happens quickly, that we can move from pilot to full implementation as quickly as possible. And it sounds like you're all ready to help make this happen. So we're going to hear from the administration next. But before that, I want to make sure that if there are any other members or Chair Cabrera, if you had any questions.
Thank you so much, Co-Chair. I appreciate your questions. You pretty much asked all the questions I had except one. And that is, if you could share with us how taxing has this season been on your budget? Not of the fact that I'm sure that you have an unprecedented amount of clients coming through your nonprofits, dealing with translations and the SOAR. If you could just give us a brief panorama of what you're facing. And by the way, how sustainable that is and how long would you have the capacity based on the funding that you have right now?
Speaking from the perspective of advocating on behalf of 70 grassroots Asian American nonprofits, what we're hearing from these organizations that, we're all, between a rock and a hard place. We're having our budgets cut, but the demand isn't just level, it's actually expanding dramatically in specific constituencies like our most vulnerable, our senior population, our small businesses. The need is increasing and the resources are decreasing in almost every service sector. I think universally we've all been holding our breath for quite some time to see how, budgets will shape up, but we know the direction it's going in right now. I can just speak for us though.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I think, the same for us in our member organizations. I think we've been fortunate to provide direct cash assistance to individuals and organizations, mostly through, philanthropy that has provided money specifically to the undocumented community. But this is where, we looked for the city to actually step in, because it's really not the job of community organizations and nonprofit organizations to hold and bolster up communities in times like this. We just don't have the capacity, and we've had to switch all of the work that we've been doing over to direct aid, whether it's, in person or hosting Facebook Lives, or, just using any means that we can to get both the word out and get assistance to the communities all across the city. But we really need the city to step up in so many ways, and language access is one of the ways, but obviously direct aid is another way. And they're just really making sure that particularly the hardest hit communities, which happen to be immigrant communities, are served and are restored.
Thank you so much.
I would just add really quickly that it is not sustainable to keep on doing this for a long time. We've been doing diapers. I think we've been doing food. We've been doing cash assistance. The rent, I didn't talk about the rent application. People were left to do that on their own, the state rent application. And we've been open since April, again, taking our staff, taking some risks. But in order to serve, as we were speaking about, like the most vulnerable community members who maybe don't know how to read or write or who speak these indigenous languages, there is no other option but to be able to serve them sometimes in person. And so it is definitely not sustainable. And that's why I think that we are looking for ways to be able to have the city learn these ways of doing things with our community members, because we're a small organization. And so we've like many organizations, grassroots organizations have stepped in. But like Theo said, we're looking forward to the city, you know, learning this and being able to implement it systemically into citywide agencies.
Thank you so much. Let me give back to the chair, my co-chair.
Thank you, Chair Cabrera. And we can go back to the moderator, Harbani, if there's any other questions. Otherwise, we can head over to the administration. And thank you again to this panel to open this discussion. And really, we're going to want some action. So we'll hear about that from the admin.
Thank you, Chair. At this time, there are no other questions. So I'd like to thank this panel for your testimony. And now we will be moving on to administration testimony. I will be now calling on members of the administration to testify. Testimony will be provided by the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs Commissioner, Bita Mostofi, and Executive Director of External Affairs at DCWP, Steve Edinani. Additionally, the following representatives will be available for answering questions: Anne Montesano, Executive Director of Interagency Initiatives and Language Access at MOIA. Before we begin, I will administer the oath. Commissioner Mostofi, Executive Director Steve Edinani, and Executive Director Anne Montesano, I will call on you each individually for a response. Please raise your right hands. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions? Commissioner Mostofi?
I do.
Thank you. Executive Director Steve Edinani?
I do.
Thank you. Executive Director Anne Montesano?
I do.
Thank you. Commissioner Mostofi, you may begin when you are ready.
Starting time.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you to Chairman Chaka, Chair Cabrera, and members of the Committees of Immigration and Government Operations for calling this hearing today. I'm Bita Mostofi. I'm the Commissioner for the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs. Language access poses a distinct challenge in New York City, which is one of the most linguistically diverse places in the world, with more than 200 languages spoken. About a quarter of the city has limited English proficiency, meaning that these individuals are more likely to have challenges accessing English materials or receiving information in the English language. City government bears the responsibility of ensuring that those New Yorkers with LEP have the opportunity and ability to engage with the services and programs that they need, both during normal times and amid a crisis. MOIA has worked to make a concerted effort in collaboration with the city agencies to improve language access, especially after the passage of Local Law 30, by working with them to build the city's language access infrastructure and expand the availability of language access services. We've helped agencies develop their language access implementation plans, or LAIPs, designated language access coordinators at every agency that's under Local Law 30, and procure contracts with professional language services in order to ensure that they can administer these services for the public, as well as incorporate guidance and best practices and provide technical assistance. Owing to this groundwork, MOIA has helped to lay over the past few years, the city was able to promptly adapt its operation to respond in rapid increase of the demand for language services during the COVID-19 pandemic. Let me be clear, the pandemic exposed continuing challenges around language access, which we take very seriously. But it is the city's work over the past few years in implementing Local Law 30 that did allow us to begin to address those challenges in a more swift and effective way. We continue to assess both the best practices and the gaps in service that were identified during recent months as we work towards greater language justice for all New Yorkers. And we look forward to discussing this with members of the council today and listening to advocates' testimony. My testimony will be brief in discussing the ways in which we've worked with city agencies to implement Local Law 30 and how we address language access needs during the pandemic. After Local Law 30 was passed in 2017, we worked with the Mayor's Office of Operation to provide guidance and oversight to the city agency partners in developing, as I noted, their plans and the infrastructure that they needed to implement them. This has included educating agencies on the law's requirements, ensuring the agencies have in place the requisite staff and training that staff, and helping to develop individualized plans to implement along with, as I noted, the contracts needed to do so. Ongoing work with agencies has focused on bolstering their capacity to provide language access by developing shared resources and best practices to learn from each other and to continue for our office to provide technical assistance. To support these efforts, we've created an online portal for all agencies to share language access resources or materials, to provide trainings that can be used for staff or the onboarding of new staff, procedures or best practices for things like website accessibility, and tools for staff to improve how they can communicate with and serve New Yorkers with LEP. We've also convened language access coordinators at least twice a year to address topics such as how to work more effectively with vendors, how to incorporate interpretation best practices, how to develop language access procedures, and how to improve accessibility of licenses, permits, and registrations. Notably, agencies learn a tremendous amount from each other. And we've also worked to incorporate additional measures like brown bags and conversations to learn from one another. In fact, in October, for example, we worked with the Department of Transportation to host a brown bag for agencies so that DOT could share information about how it's made its licenses, permits, and registration more accessible through online multilingual portals. MOYA has continued to increase our own language access capabilities, and we've deepened the language services work through Local Law 30 in coordination with other mayoral offices. Our services team has seen a dramatic increase in the number of requests that we've received. For example, we saw a 500% increase in the number of translations provided from 2018 to 2020. The complexity of documents and the number of languages into which documents have been translated has also increased. We've tried to work nimbly to respond to the rise in the demand and to provide access or support to agencies as they've needed it. We've integrated professional tools and best practices ourselves so that we can better inform how agencies do this work. As one example, we've piloted a tool for our website that does human translation in all the city's top 10 languages instead of Google Translate. The work that we do with our agencies and have done to implement Local Law 30 has helped to establish a robust and collaborative foundation on which we still have a lot of work to do to build. Today, all the agencies have plans, they all have coordinators, they have contracts for professional language service vendors, and they are regularly attending and engaging with our office to improve the accessibility of the work. I'm gonna skip to COVID-19 response in the interest of time. Despite this progress on language access during recent years, COVID revealed the work that still remains. The pandemic showed us that the city still faces tremendous challenges in quickly disseminating multilingual information to New Yorkers who do not speak English. Some of the ways in which we responded was first, as in other emergencies, we worked with the Emergency Management Office to convene a task force on language access. We did this in early March. We worked to identify the issues or challenges that would arise and how we could better coordinate resources and reach the most New Yorkers. Through this task force, we worked most closely with the Department of Health to ensure that that agency, as the lead agency, had ample language services, resources, and were assessing the critical need to make sure that this was more inclusive than just the city's top 10 languages. So moving to 25 translations for languages across that agency. And we also coordinated with pro bono vendors to add services if they were needed. MOYA also coordinated extensively with other agencies during the pandemic. We relied on our network of language access coordinators to provide regular guidance, technical assistance, particularly around digital resources as it became more critical during this moment in time. We responded to urgent needs that were brought to our attention from community partners, including expanding our own budget and working with our translation vendor to secure faster translations in a more effective and efficient way. Our language services team alone experienced an over 580% increase in the number of translations projects that we delivered in fiscal year 2020 as compared to 2019. We also adjusted our communications and outreach strategies to ensure faster dissemination of critical and ever-changing multilingual content. We developed shorter graphics with plainer language that we could develop quickly. We created audio messages in different languages, and we worked to do virtual town halls and convenings as well in many different languages with our agency partners. Finally, we developed multilingual resources that could serve as a centralized place for New Yorkers and our incredible infrastructure of community-based providers across the city to have access to something that we continue to readily update and also informs the frequently asked questions that we've developed and continue to translate. It is available in 25 different languages. In response to specific requests that we received from business owners, we worked with SBS to improve the translation of key pieces of collateral into different languages, and we increased access to information around with webinars, technical assistance, and digital advertising in many different languages. SBS has also established a business assistance hotline that can serve people in over 200 languages in response to some of the issues that were presented. Similarly, the Department of Consumer and Worker Protection took additional steps to make critical information more accessible, and I know they will be speaking momentarily to share some of that. Finally, while the city has made significant progress in integrating language access into agency operations and planning, we know that there's still a tremendous amount of work to be done to realize the true vision of Local Law 30. We're committed to continuing to work with the council and our agency partners and community providers in trying to address these gaps and improve language access in our city. As we endeavor to support New Yorkers with LEP across many facets of this ongoing crisis, we'll rely on the work that we've done and the lessons that we have learned to improve these experiences in short order. Thank you again for calling this hearing. I thank the committee for taking this important topic very seriously and look forward to the conversation.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to note that Councilmember Eugene has joined us for the record. We will now turn to testimony from DCWP, Executive Director Steve Edinani. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good afternoon, Chairman Chaka, Chair Cabrera, and members of the committees. I'm Steven Edinani, Executive Director of External Affairs for the Department of Consumer and Worker Protection. On behalf of Commissioner Salas, I want to share our thanks and appreciation to the committees for continuing to elevate the voices of New York's vibrant and diverse immigrant communities across the city. Now more than ever before, our collective work is vital to ensuring the health, safety, and prosperity of all New Yorkers. Our city has one of the most diverse marketplaces in the world, and language access is a special responsibility for our city government to take up on behalf of New Yorkers. Commissioner Salas, as an immigrant, and as an alumnus of our CUNY system and its commendable programs to serve new New Yorkers of limited English proficiency, has since her appointment made language access a priority for our agency across all our programs. With the passage and implementation of Local Law 30, we have steadfastly worked to execute a language access plan that supports all our constituencies. First and foremost, whenever a New Yorker visits our offices, financial empowerment centers, licensing center, or small business support center, they will find multilingual signage and collateral informing them of the availability of free and real-time interpretation services through our vendor language line. Should constituents with limited English proficiency request assistance on site or contact us by other means, our staff is trained to utilize these interpretation services. Similarly, all of our inspectors are trained with language line and equipped with cards that describe interpretation services in 20 languages. When they encounter a merchant with limited English proficiency in the field, they leverage those services to communicate during an inspection. As we testified to at our hearing on workplace safety last Friday, DCWP has continued to serve our workers, consumers, and businesses with important information and equitable language access. At the start of the pandemic, we launched nyc.gov/DCWP alerts as a dedicated landing page for the public to view updated department guidance during the crisis. On the webpage, the information we provide is translated in at least the 10 designated citywide languages. Other documents found on the landing page include those developed with New York City Small Business Services and the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. These resources, again, each translated into the 10 designated languages, address broad public safety protocols, as well as guidance for what employers must do before they reopen, what workers should expect, and how to reach out to the city if there are questions. 2 weeks ago, we also issued reopening guidance on our landing page for domestic workers, many of whom have immigrant backgrounds or have preferences for languages other than English. As the home of the city's dedicated paid care division, this guidance incorporates public health and safety guidelines on behalf of a vulnerable and traditionally underserved workforce trying to navigate safety in a unique workplace environment. Lastly, since March, DCWP has conducted over 300 virtual and in-person outreach events. At our events, we provide translated outreach materials, real-time interpretation services to New Yorkers. These events also include over 30 business education days where we've visited about 2,100 businesses disseminating guidance on safe reopening standards, helping merchant associations and business improvement districts to distribute personal protective equipment as well. Turning now to Introduction 63, this legislation requires the agency to record the language of preference of our licensees, translate post-inspection communications to licensees, and utilize their language preference for their specific post-inspection communication. DCWP already offers licensees the opportunity, both on their new app license applications or renewal applications, to choose a language of preference. Of more than 70,000 licensees, 2,500 have indicated a language preference other than English. I would also note that many businesses we inspect are not licensees of DCWP. Although they're still required to comply with the city's consumer protection law, city's workplace laws, or other consumer and worker protections. As I mentioned earlier in my testimony, when we visit any business location, our inspectors are trained how to access real-time interpretation. DCWP has concerns regarding the fiscal implications of this legislation and broadly how best to approach meaningful language access. Fiscally, the agency would encounter a tremendous burden in translating documents outside the scope of our language access plan. Furthermore, the materials contemplated by this bill for translation are often uniquely specific to an individual or business. Notice of hearings, for example, include direct references to the administrative code and even contemporaneous notes by our inspectors. In such cases, DCWP believes it is more effective to provide real-time interpretation to our merchants should they have questions about their inspection. To conclude, I want to reiterate that DCWP and this administration are committed to providing equitable and fair language access to New Yorkers. I would like to thank you for the opportunity to testify today, and I look forward to any questions you may have.
Thank you for your testimony. I will now turn it over to questions from Chairman Chaka, followed by Chair Cabrera. Panelists, please stay unmuted if you can during this question and answer period. Thank you. Chairman Chaka, please begin.
Thank you. And I want to say thank you to Commissioner Mustafi and Executive Director Etanani for being here today and talking about this very, really, really important service that the city is committed to, not just because of its commitment to immigrants, but also because of local law 30. And I think what we're going to try to do is really focus on just how we can work better together to ensure that our communities have the services that they're needing right now. And if there are hurdles, to identify them and remove them from completion. And so there's no doubt that I know that your agencies are working really hard to ensure that there are services. I think what we want to do is just get a sense about what is the issue. You've heard from the first panel that even now, with incredible progress that both of you are really speaking to, you have families that are separated from information that is going out in English and not getting to them. And so everything that we're doing right now is not working. And so we're really, maybe that's the first kind of big question, is what is the hurdle here? Where are we in deficiency? Is this a strategy issue? Is this a funding issue? And let's start there. Maybe Commissioner Mustafi, you wanna start?
Sure, yeah. Thank you for the question. You know, I'll start with sort of a couple thoughts. One is a recognition that it's a pretty new law, right? Local Law 30 came into life in 2018. That began the process of developing the plans and the infrastructure. And then you're really talking about implementation the last 2 years and looking at that. And I think we have seen how that has impacted the differences, I think, maybe across some agencies, where some who were previously covered by Executive Order 120 might be further along sort of in the development or the implementation of Local Law 30, might have a much stronger infrastructure and just culture, right? Agency culture and understanding language access and a more it's more inherently a part of the work. And so I do think that sort of like cultural shift or change and prioritization takes time. And so I would just note sort of out the gate that that's an observation, right? And we've tried to think through and welcome additional thoughts, sort of how best to ensure that it's a top to bottom understanding and priority. As I said, developing tools that can be used and implemented. We've seen some agencies move themselves to identify sort of full-time staff that work on this issue. We've seen a lot of progress across many, many, many agencies in kind of how they're implementing Local Law 30. But I think the number one thing I would say is a recognition that there's newness to the work, and in particular, there's a difference sort of in the ability to move quickly depending on where agencies were at the start of implementation. I would acknowledge that some of that is resource, right? There's a resource gap in some of that. Again, some agencies have been able to focus on certain staff in the implementation process. Where there have been gaps in resources around translation or interpretation, we've been able to meet those along the way. So I don't think those have been the clear hurdles, but there's also, it's a growing field. I guess that's the last thing I would say before turning it to Anne, meaning that new tools or ideas are developed. And we are trying as Moya to sort of test them and pilot them to then be able to make the case more broadly for their utilization across agencies. But even that process, you know, we're now, as you know, piloting a technology tool around website translation. Just getting to the place of launching it took, you know, 6 months to a year, right? Identifying a better tool, working to bring on a vendor, and then doing the work to set it up and then get it out, right? So I just want to sort of say that kind of all of these factors, right, probably contribute to the gaps, and acknowledge that from the first panel, we heard, I think, mostly about gaps for languages that are not covered by Local Law 30. There was some acknowledgement there are still challenges with the Local Law 30 languages, but many of the specific things that we were hearing about limited diffuse languages or harder to reach populations, right? You're talking about a sphere of languages that fall outside the local law. So I think that presents a different kind of challenge as well. Anne, do you want to add anything to what I shared?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would just, can you hear me?
Yes.
There's some feedback. Okay. There's been tremendous progress over the years, and yet we know the work is ongoing and there's a lot of work to do. What we really spent the first few years of LL30 implementation doing is really establishing what we call this language access infrastructure across all agencies, and agencies kind of came into this at different places, right? So we really wanted to make sure all agencies have language access implementation plans. They all have language access coordinators. They all have the requisite contracts in place. We've seen a tremendous increase in the expenditures relating to language services over the years, which I think is just one indicator that agencies are doing better at this and progress is being made. It's been pretty incredible to kind of review agencies' progress and see even the progress in terms of translated materials, right? In calendar year 2019, DSS translated over 1,400 materials into the local law 30 languages, Department of Transportation over 200 materials. And, you know, there are other examples of other agencies. Agencies have made progress in terms of the quality of the translation. So agencies have gotten additional contracts with secondary translation vendors to do sort of QA checks on those translations. Agencies are developing glossaries. As Bita mentioned, there are agencies that have done some reorganization to really approach the language access implementation better at their agencies. So ACS, hired another staffer and now has more centralized staffers that kind of provide centralized guidance and oversight on language access. SBS has a language access coordinator, but they also have language access division leads. And so it's also really interesting, I think, not just to see, you know, in terms of numbers, the provision of language services, but one thing we also try to get agencies to think about is how are you structured internally to be able to do this work? And we've seen different examples of that.
Thank you, Anne, for and both of you really to kind of share perspective. I think that there are a couple of things that I just want to maybe reset in this conversation. And while Local Law 30 is new, the executive order 120 was in place for a long time, and that had a smaller amount of languages that were required for translation and engagement from the administration, well, from the city. And so, which is why we have, I guess, what you're kind of laying out, a long-term relationship with restructuring agencies. And the local law went a little bit further, and which is why we're really wanting to really understand what's the issue here. And I think with COVID, this has really presented not just an opportunity, but a recommitment to these languages at the onset. You've heard from the advocates about new ideas that can actually serve languages that are outside the 10. We're talking about some of the indigenous languages, but also even Spanish in the DOE. We're hearing from advocates that Spanish still becomes an afterthought in the initial release of information. And so I think this is deeper. I think this is deeper than the newness of a law, the kind of working with agencies. This doesn't seem like a priority for this administration when people need information about what's happening at a very rapid pace. And, I think I was just kind of thinking about like, what do we have to do to get this to happen? And essentially, it's like every time an English message comes out, it has to be met with all the other languages, or else it doesn't go out. And if that were a hurdle, then we're all feeling the need for information, like our immigrant populations and non-English speaking LEP communities. And I think that's the urgency. I feel it when I said that. I felt it. That's what we're not seeing right now. And so I think I have some other questions about some of the pieces that you laid out, but I want to give you an opportunity to respond to that, and then hand it over to Chair Cabrera.
Sure. I mean, I can respond. You know, one of the things that Anne noted is it's not that we haven't devoted resources or priorities here. And one indicator, of course, is money, right? Is how much money has been has been spent comparatively to before the passage of Local Law 30. And it's literally, and this isn't even encompassing of the entirety of the expenditure or even some of the agencies that you listed that are outside of the Local Law 30 infrastructure, like DOE, like HNH, right, that have their own budgets and operations around language access. We've seen since the implementation of Local Law 30, a literal doubling of the amount of money that has been spent through the key vendors, the DCAS contracts, to translation and interpretation services. So going from about 5 million to about 10 million, that's not insignificant, right? Just to, in what we can look at and sort of use to understand, are people prioritizing this from, you know, internal to like the outcome to the actual dollars that are being put towards here? And the answer I think is yes, that's happening. Is it happening at the pace in which it's critical to happen? And I think in the pandemic, you know, one of the challenges is people got to a place where your timeline is set for releasing something. And so you're budgeting within that timeline a certain process for translation. And we have really emphasized and Anne spoke to this a little bit, the importance of quality assurance and recognizing that, you know, what's the point in doing the translation if you're not getting it right, right? And that's an ongoing issue that we continue to need to look at and work on. And so time gets budgeted or allocated to ensure that that's done effectively. And the pandemic sort of flipped that switch a little bit, which was there isn't time, right? So in thinking about your question of like, the urgency in making the decision of do I release this before I have the English language, before I have the other languages in place, because I want to ensure that there's a process to do that effectively. Those were decisions that were made, and we did make some adjustments to ensure that we within a 24-hour period could get where we needed to get. But I would lie if I said that wasn't a challenge for all the reasons that I articulated.
I guess my main point is that if this was a priority, we'd figure out how to do this. At the micro level, organizations like say some of our district offices, they build capacity for X, Y, and Z. And I think that's what we're trying to highlight here and really trying to figure out what that leap is. And if it's budget, then let's work budget. But we'll talk about those pieces after the members talk, because I wanna give everybody else an opportunity to ask questions. And then we can drill down on some of that. Because what we want to come out of this conversation today is a sense of partnership and coalition that include you all who are on the inside and will be able to fight with us for those resources, strategy, and focus. Chair Cabrera?
Thank you to my co-chair. As a matter of fact, if I may, let me just follow up briefly on the cost, since you mentioned DCAS, from 5 million to 10 million, did I hear correctly, Commissioner?
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, here are my brief thoughts before I go into my line of questions. We're spending close to, actually over $1 billion when it comes to PPE, food distribution. So I would think that, to be honest with you, that's very little money if it's going to sabotage or interfere or create speed bumps for people to get the information that they need. I'm not minimizing $5 million, it's $5 million. But is that $5 million going to affect the efficiency and effectiveness of the DOE? Department of Health, because communication is everything. That, you know, something for us to reconsider, that it is money very much well spent. And to look at maybe if we need to start looking at in-house or whether, you know, coming with some other innovative ways to going about it. I don't know if you want to respond to that, but if not, I'll get to my questions.
Sure, I can briefly. You know, as I noted, I was just pointing to as an indicator that progress has happened quickly over 2 years. Okay. Right, to double, that was more what I was pointing out. And I also want to recognize that in particular, some of the agencies that you noted, DOE, H&H, they're not included in that number. They, you know, DOE has an in-house unit, actually, which is arguably a best practice for this work. So, you know, I don't think we're unaligned. I just wanted to point that out.
Okay, I'm glad to hear that. That's so good. Let me get to DCWP. I know you changed your name, so used to always calling you the Department of Consumer Affairs.
Right.
But in what languages, if you could help me here quickly, if you could just give me the short version, because I have a few questions here. In what languages are DCWP inspectors able to conduct inspections without relying on interpreter or interpretation services?
Thank you for the question, Chair. Our inspectors, along with, you know, External Affairs, the agency that I'm representing, and each division, they certainly have their own language expertise just inherently as staff members. I know our inspectors are proficient in Spanish and Arabic, and depending on deployment and geography, in some cases, those inspectors are utilized strategically to ensure that language gaps are addressed.
I'm sorry, just to save you time, do you have specific language?
I can get back to you on the exact number of languages, okay. But essentially what the process is for inspectors when they go on a patrol inspection, they enter a business where there's a merchant or a business that may be LEP, is that there is a language line card that they provide that has instructions in 20 different languages, and that merchant may be able to point to that language, and then language line is utilized to bridge that gap to provide real-time interpretive services. Those 20 languages are just on the card. The language line process, I think it's over 140, 150 different languages that can be accessed there.
So that leads me to the next question. Are all DCWP inspection-related materials, including FAQs and application forms, available in all 10 city designated languages? And if not, which materials are yet to be translated and why?
So thank you for the question. I think it's really important that we kind of discuss this a bit. Our language access plan is actually identifies and articulates that we will be translating the top five most distributed materials into designated language, as well as the top five application materials related to the top five license categories. Those license categories include categories like secondhand dealers, tobacco retail dealers, laundries, and such. In terms of the top documents, we're talking about things like our free tax prep program brochures, our financial empowerment brochures that connect individuals to free financial counseling. All of those materials are in process of being translated for the public. In terms of inspection and post-inspection materials, and this is what I was alluding to a little bit in my testimony today, is that we actually believe, in terms of the post-inspection materials, that the best way to serve and bridge language gaps is through a real-time interpretive service, as opposed to translating documents that are oftentimes unique and specific to the business at hand. For example, if an inspector visits a tobacco retail dealer, there may be notes that the inspector makes in that document contemporaneously that would be very resource intensive, quite frankly, for us to translate on a unique basis for each individual business, depending on what occurred on that inspection. And I think moreover, and most importantly, we just don't think that's an effective way to kind of bridge language access gaps, as opposed to having a telephone number or a multilingual blurb, which exists for things like notice of hearings already, to ensure that folks have access to interpretive services over the telephone.
So help me understand this. If an individual does not read English proficiently, how they are to know that they can reach out to you to seek real-time interpretation within this 30-day cure window? I know you want a real-time, but if I can't read in English, how am I going to know I have this opportunity afforded to me?
Yeah, so the notice of hearing that is handed to a merchant has a multilingual blurb. So a merchant that receives that notice of hearing is going to be able to understand that blurb and be able to contact us. I think also practically speaking, a lot of folks call and make appointments at DCWP, and we'll also have access individually with staff to kind of bridge those gaps as well using language lines. So there is a level of interpretive or translation that is on those documents. It's just not the entire document for the reasons I mentioned before, because a lot of these documents are extremely tailored to the business.
And how many languages is in the...
I believe it's 7 or so, but I can get you the specific number and the individual languages after this hearing.
Now, the DCWP language access plan has not been updated since 2018, and we don't have an updated timelines for the translations. Can you please provide those to us?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, and perhaps the commissioner can speak to this a little bit more, but we're on a 3-year cadence in terms of updating our language access plan. I think, as was correctly mentioned by Chairman Chaka at the top of the program, our most updated language access plan is from 2018. And our next plan is due next year, and we will be updating on our progress on those matters as well.
Okay, and last question to you before I go to the commission and talk about Puerto Rico. How do the DCWP inspectors prepare before they get to for an inspection? Do they know the language in which that the owner speaks? And if so, how does that help?
Yeah, absolutely. So right now, it's part of our current process that there is a question for licensees to note their language preference to the agency. I believe 2,500 or so licensees already make that preference known to us. In those cases, we use that information greatly. We, for example, have scheduled inspections, if it's related to weights and measures or otherwise, we'll use that information to ensure that the inspector that's going there is either prepared to use language line or has, an institutional knowledge or proficiency in that language before they visit that business. Mm. Also, and I think importantly, and as I mentioned, this is really a top-down approach. Our commitment to language access flows down from Commissioner Salas. She's an immigrant herself. She actually instituted a program, the VIP program for inspection, which offers the first touch point that a new licensee would have with our agency is an educational visit. So when a business, for example, indicates a preference for a language, we ensure that the collateral, the educational and outreach materials that we bring to that educational visit is in the language that they prefer and as indicated to us.
Thank you so much. Commissioner, real quick, regarding the Office of Puerto Rico, New York City Affairs, what kind of resources we would need in order to establish an Office of Puerto Rico, New York City Affairs?
I can't speak to that question, unfortunately. I'm sorry, that's not within my bailiwick, but also something that we have tried to make very clear as the Office of Immigrant Affairs is that Puerto Ricans aren't immigrants, that they are U.S. citizens, and we have instead tried to advise our sister agencies, for example, in the aftermath of Hurricane Maria, when service centers or hubs were created to support folks on just best practices in helping new arrivals and in making sure information was available in the Spanish language. But I think we'd have to get back to you on your initial question.
Do we have anybody, because we knew we were going to have a hearing regarding this bill, do we have anybody here in administration to address this bill? I'll guess our staff will reach to their staff in the back end. Maybe we could get somebody on board, because this is an important bill. I have a lot of questions. I'm sure my co-chair does as well. In light of what happened in Puerto Rico, I don't even know how many people from Puerto Rico came and living here permanently. What would this cost? I mean, this is an important bill. You know, what kind of staffing we're going to need? What kind of coordinations do we have with Puerto Rico? Now, I know you mentioned denying immigrants. We'll know that, but sometimes it feels like a colony, to be honest with you. And so Puerto Rico, in this so-called Commonwealth situation, is in a very, they're living in an impossible situation, literally. And I know this goes beyond what the city could ultimately do as a federal government. I'll appear to my co-chair, and I'll give it back to him. We do need answers, especially since we had a hearing on this particular important bill. And also in light of the fact that Council Member Torres, soon to be a congressman, we have a limited amount of time. I would like for him to get his due. He's right now getting trained to become a congressman in D.C., So co-chair, give it back to you.
Thank you.
Briefly, sorry, I would just add, like with any agency, there would need to be an assessment on the mission or goals of the organization, right? What their infrastructure would need to look like by way of all the things, right? What they're required to do and what is needed to be put into place to do that. That's my understanding generally of how that would work, but I can't speak to more specifics on this question.
And Commissioner, I didn't want to put you in the spot because really it was not ultimately, but you were the closest thing.
I understand.
Getting a closest person in the administration to getting an answer here. I didn't see anybody else here, so I had to go your way. But in all fairness to the council member, to the chairs on this committee, and to be honest with you, to Puerto Ricans, we need to have answers, specific answers, so we could move appropriately on this bill. And so with that, co-chair, thank you, Commissioner and Secretary.
Thank you.
Thank you, co-chair. And I do have some questions, but I do want to emphasize the need for someone to get back to us about this bill. This essentially can move through the council without any response from the mayor's office, and we don't want that. We want to work with you to really build something out. So as a mayor representative, I hope that we can get that. And if it can happen in real time, we'll take it too, and we'll guide you right into this hearing. I want to say one more thing about that while Puerto Rican diaspora in the city of New York are as you're labeling them, not immigrants, I think that this presents us an opportunity to rethink the city's response to the LEP community in our city. And these are folks that they may be citizens and not speak English. And so this is really gonna, I think, confront all of our preconceived notions about communities and how we label them, and instead really kind of focus on the access to services and removing language barriers for anyone and everyone. And so this is something that I've learned as a chair of the Immigration Committee, that we're really talking about just New Yorkers and removing barriers. I'll just leave it there. Let's continue that conversation. I want to ask some questions about Local Law 30 and implementation. And I understand that we just got a report from you all. Is that right? The 2019 report?
Yeah.
Okay. That was due in June, correct?
Yeah, you know, I think as with many things related to the implementation of local laws, we had requested an extension to give agencies time in light of the pandemic to be responsive to the report's requirements and deadline.
Okay, and the reason I kind of asked that is the report really brought back some information that not much of it was, there were no massive improvements in terms of agencies updating their plans. And so if you can just speak to that you didn't really see any, and look, we just got it minutes ago. So I'm trying to skip through it. So is that true? That essentially agencies have not done the work that the local law is asking them to do, which is to update their plans. And in this moment where we are asking for critical emergency information, that they haven't necessarily improved much since 2018.
So I'll say a couple of things. We are also just reviewing the reports, right? We're sharing it with you in parallel to our MOIA receiving the reports and reviewing them so that you have them in a more timely fashion. But in terms of the plans, the local, I think Steve spoke to this, local law does not require an annual update on the plans. It requires every 3 years an update on the plans, meaning that next year is the time in which the agencies are required to review their plans and do an update to their plans. So what we're really looking at this year is continued implementation of the plans that were created last year.
And can I just add, so, you know, the law obviously, as you know, does require annual reports, and those agencies do submit to us every year. I believe this is this, you know, we've received now two cycles of their annual reports. And so those reflect sort of the progress they've made on their implementation. And so those are the ones we're reviewing now.
Okay. We're looking forward to really understanding what that is. And I did hear that in 2020, one agency did upgrade or update the plan, and that was HRA. So thank you.
Well, can I actually clarify that? So DSS did provide their annual report. They post that on their website. That's per local law 73, not per local law 30. And so all agencies are required to have those updates, and we collect those and review them. But local law 30 doesn't require agencies to post those reports, but DSS has, because they're covered under a different law. And they've done a really great job. Their report is really exemplary, and we commend them for their work.
And I would note, in light of the fact that there is a requirement to do updated plans, right, for next year, that feedback or insights from the council or providers on particular agencies is really helpful at this time.
I actually just want to correct myself from earlier. We do actually have I had mentioned that our last plan on our website was from 2018, and we actually have a plan from May 2020 that's on our website. So I can provide that link to you, Chair, for your staff to review as well. So
thank you.
I did want to correct the record there.
Thank you. Thank you. And that will show up for the next year's report in 2020. But thank you for that update. And this is, so maybe to that request, Commissioner, the lag time between the times we get the report and the moment, like here we're getting one that was published in May, but I think that there's an opportunity to do something completely different here. And I don't want to lose the voice of the first panel that are offering a whole different way of updating plans of the agencies and creating new infrastructure that they can start embedding themselves into if we have the resources and strategy and leadership across the board. And I think that's more exciting. That's more what we think is not just game changing, but could be quick in implementation. And so maybe that's what we can do, is commit to sitting down and saying, okay, how are we gonna anticipate a budget this next June that has these resources, make sure that that happens so that we can start getting all the agencies to support in this kind of hub kind of way, language access and translations and all the things that we need. So that's not here yet, but that's really the vision I think that I want to offer in response to your willingness to sit down with us. Okay, question. So Local Law 30 of 2017 requires the city to publish the 10 citywide designated languages based on specific formula using census and DOE enrollment data. How often does the mayor's office assess which languages are the 10 citywide designated languages?
So we did the initial assessment in 2018 in advance of the plans being developed and implemented. There's nothing that specifically indicates the frequency in which we should, but I think, you know, we have internally discussed that we think coming on the sort of every 3-year revision of the plans, it makes sense for us to do a check, right, on whether or not we're still in the right sort of focus on the 10 languages. But that's something also we're open to feedback. We haven't made a final decision around.
Okay, I think we might have some ideas that we might want to share with you all about that. Next, a review of the language access plans of COVID-19 show that very few have been updated. We just talked about that. Which do you think, and this is more of a question about your current conversations, which do you think will be working with you to get those things updated? And maybe that can help connect to the idea that we just had, which is maybe work with them since they're rolling on it to really build this new pilot.
Sorry, I'm not sure I understood the question.
Are there any agencies that are really aggressively working with you to update their plans, and which ones are they so that we can work with them to maybe build out this pilot?
We work with all of the agencies, right, that are identified under the local law. And as you have sort of the update on progress on implementation of Local Law 30. And so part of our job at this point is, while continuing the existing efforts, is in reviewing the updates, ascertaining sort of where we want to or will need to focus by way of additional supports or needs to get people to stronger places. I think on the plans, that's people have not yet begun their work on the plans. Those are due next year. So as I said, this is an early time to start conversations around what those could look like.
Okay. Is Moya copied on the language access complaints that 311 receives? And if so, how does Moya work to ensure that these complaints are addressed?
Yeah, so we've been working really closely actually in the last few months with 311 at trying to address what we think are just systems that can be better, and ones in which we can all do a better job of being held accountable to. So we're changing, this is technical for 311 purposes, but we're changing the sort of label or tag that these complaints receive, so that now they get essentially held also by GUID, so by the 311 team, as well as our office, and they are delivered to an agency with a period of time to resolve them, which is not what currently happens. So it's harder to sort of be, to do a follow-up or to be responsive to them. So this is a bigger systems change that GUID has been an incredible partner with us on, as now sort of taking over the implementation of 311, and we hope we're already sort of in the midst of changing this process, and we'll hopefully have a sense soon of when it will be complete.
So having a district office where we are constantly being challenged to communicate multiple languages, and even we are going through evolution often about how we do that, how rapidly can we do that, and building out the staff to make that happen, and working with partners. We think a lot about feedback, And so I'm thinking about 311 as a place where people can go to make a complaint or make a suggestion. Does Moya have a mechanism in which they let people know that 311 is that way through to the city to say, hey, this didn't work for you, so tell us. And what does that look like?
Yeah, we do it in a few ways. And progress has been made already systems-wise, I should acknowledge, on the 311 side, in that those complaints can be recorded now without having to call, right? Which didn't previously exist. That's within the last year. And now again, we're trying to improve that system in the way that kind of accountability and solutions, I should say, have to happen from the complaints. So that, you know, that's been one area of focus, is just that systems and sort of operations question. In terms of educating people on this avenue of submitting complaints, it's a part of the work that we do as an agency in terms of ensuring people know kind of what their rights are and what to do in the event that they're not receiving information in the languages that they have the right to. We additionally work to ensure that this is a part of the training that we work with our Know Your Rights providers around. And it is also a part of what our constituent services team will identify and help to address. Some agencies themselves have infrastructure to receive these complaints and follow through on them, which I think is notable because that is in some ways where the majority will go. And then lastly, I think we're open to greater suggestions. I think we recognize that a lot of people who are LEP aren't necessarily using that 311 channel, right? So we've been open to thinking through better ways of directly receiving the information or working directly with sister agencies. We've worked with the Mayor's Office of Operations to work directly with agencies at looking at their services on our own, right? Without waiting, if you will, for complaints to come in. But we're certainly open to additional suggestions.
One other way that we've raised awareness.
Oh no, Anne went on mute. Can we unmute Anne? Okay, go ahead.
I think I'm back. One other way that we've raised awareness about the complaint channel is through developing multilingual signage, which we've distributed. And so some agencies have that in their walk-in sites as well.
Got it. Okay. What guidance has the mayor's office disseminated to agencies about serving the LEP population that do not speak one of the 10 designated languages during an emergency?
I'll start, but really, Anne, you and Ken lead this effort, so you should really speak. As I said, we work closely with OEM during any emergency effort. They will activate what is our language access task force, and Anne usually and or Ken will join immediately to help assess what the language needs are for a particular population or community in that emergency effort, and work directly with the agency that's the lead agency to put into place the right measures, right? Whatever that might look like, and to make recommendations. And so, Anne, you want to speak maybe more to specific, maybe past emergency efforts and sort of what that looks like, or even in COVID, how we worked initially?
Yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, one of the things we did with the task force initially is advise that DOHMH expand the number of languages that they translate materials into. So they began translating into additional materials. Other agencies do that too, based on their demographic. So, TLC often translates beyond the 10 into Hindi and Punjabi. DFDA translates into additional DOT based on their demographics. And then Moya, you know, internally has gone beyond that. I believe we've tried to expand the number of languages where communicating with, I think in 2019, you know, we translated materials into 40 some odd languages. This calendar year, it's been, I think, like 54 languages. So, you know, we're trying to be responsive to going beyond the local law 30 languages.
Okay. Please describe how the mayor's office tests emergency messaging.
So emergency messaging is led by OEM, and they have worked to launch at least more consistent platforms, right, in Spanish and in Chinese language for folks. And so we've been working with them on those improvements, but also in looking sort of more broadly at additional languages. We know that there was a recent error in Spanish translation of this on the school's closing messaging, and we have been in conversation with OEM at ensuring that that doesn't happen again. And so while they did have secondary review of those messages already in place, they're now adding a third layer to ensure that that doesn't happen again.
Thank you. I know we're all moving so fast, but these things have consequences, and
yeah.
I'm thankful that you are looking at that. And I'd love to work with you and try to figure out how and what you need from us to ensure that that doesn't happen again. Thank you. Let's talk about the census, because the census became this really collaborative effort where we saw the need in different ways. The council was committed to bringing the resources, and we did. And the office of the census went at it and was confronted with the pandemic, and they got us to 2010 numbers essentially, which is a heroic feat, I think, in a lot of ways, in where we are right now in communication, and the fact that immigrants do not trust government right now for all these different reasons. So all that aside, I'd love to know about that success in reaching LEP immigrant communities, and channels like WhatsApp and WeChat and Kakao. What has Moya done to really extract that learning and build out a different plan and incorporate it into how you're updating agency plans and doing all the good work?
Yeah, so I'll say a couple of things. One, to just, you know, applaud what was truly a citywide effort on the census, and really just a shared kind of value in doing everything that we could to overcome not just historical obstacles, but man-made ones by the Trump administration and the pandemic itself, right? It was really kind of all things working against a complete count. But I think because of just that shared partnership that you articulated, this really incredible historic outcome of going above what were anticipated or projected numbers even before the pandemic for the city. So it's really wonderful. I think a few things, not just census, but the pandemic itself, right, has provided us with a lot of just lessons learned on kind of how we shifted some of our work to be responsive in reaching LEP New Yorkers and immigrant New Yorkers kind of more broadly in this moment, and obviously applying lessons learned in the past. So I'll say a few things. One is to the digital sort of platforms that you spoke of, our team really focused early and often, not just on census, but across all of the information dissemination that we've been doing, to identify the right digital platforms for different language speakers, whether it was WeChat or WhatsApp or KakaoTalk or, you know, Facebook or Instagram. And then from there, we developed unique content for those streams. So, you know, videos, I think my team alone developed videos in 16 different languages, audio messages in different languages, in like social graphics, which were more readily forwarded through those channels, in the different means. I know I participated in events in WeChat or in on Facebook, many, and so forth. So that what we were doing was ensuring that we were leveraging what we could in a moment in which we needed to ensure that people were safe and precautions were taken. Additionally, and I think this speaks to the, emphasizes what the first panel shared, was we did through our emergency relief effort actually require that all of the folks that were screened for that effort that came through community-based providers were given information about the census and were supported in completing the census. And so we know thousands that came through that program also completed the census through it. And our team worked closely to be on the ground with the census teams. So, going to food pantries, going to parks, just making ourselves available once we were able to, right? And ensuring that our team was deployed that spoke the languages of the communities that we were going into. So those are some of the efforts. And to your point, I think one that I didn't know also was around website accessibility. And we sort of worked to try and address some of that by producing additional guidance and doing additional trainings with folks. So those are some of the lessons learned that I think will consistently be ones we're looking at in implementation around and advising around. Anne, do you want to add anything to that?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to seeing all those improvements in the agencies that are in the middle of improving their and updating their plans to communicate. Is that something that we can expect from these agencies, really embedding everything you just laid out in terms of the kind of victories and the work that you all did as an agency working with census team across the whole city apparatus?
It will certainly be a part of the efforts that we undertake around this work for sure, yeah.
Okay, thank you. We have another question. What guidance has the mayor's office disseminated to agencies regarding language access provision for populations with lower rates of literacy in their native language? How has the city prioritized disseminating critical COVID-19 related information in non-written formats, such as video or even audio?
Yeah, I'll start top line and then Anne, you should get more specific. So we did talk a great deal about this specifically with DOH and looking at how we were disseminating information. So DOH moved pretty quickly to video as well in the kind of creation of their information, right, in different languages. As I said, our team worked to do audio messages as well as really plain language and simple graphics in different languages, as well as video recordings or tapings in different languages. So sort of utilizing those kind of various mediums to try and disseminate information in different languages. But Anne, do you want to add anything by way of sort of systems and guidance around this?
No, I mean, I think it's just an area of ongoing work to make sure that all agencies are aware of these different ways of communicating with their limited English speaking customers and just kind of continuing to push out the way we've done it and how they can kind of do that work as well.
We focused on website accessibility, like digital accessibility in the early months because it was necessary. And then, as I said, worked directly with certain agencies that we knew were kind of launching big efforts to think through some of these pieces. So one example is around MOPT. Maybe we could talk. You want to talk a little bit, Anne, about how we supported them? So tenant protection, as well as the Mayor's Office of Sustainability.
Yeah, sure. I mean, so for MOPD, we did a lot of work with them to support their translation efforts and making their website more accessible. We worked a lot with OCME over the summer to make their website more accessible. They have a multilingual banner, I guess you would call it, on their homepage. And when you click on any one of the 10 languages, it says, you know, info in Spanish, info in French, and then you get a page of information in that language. And so we've really been providing kind of elbow-to-elbow technical assistance to agencies just to improve that piece of it.
Thank you for that. I have a few more questions before we head to the public testimony. And I also want to acknowledge Councilmember Ilanis Rodriguez, who has joined us. So my next question is about emergency preparedness plans, and NYCEM's plan states that the Interagency Language Access Task Force would be activated if the needs of an affected population exceed the capacity of that responding agency. So tell us a little bit about this task force, who staffs it, the criteria for this activation of the Interagency Language Access Task Force.
Yeah, and you want to take it?
Sure. So like you mentioned, there are a number of different triggers that can be met in order to launch the task force. We usually consult very quickly with the NYC Emergency Management Office to activate the task force. It's comprised initially of NYSEM, MOIA, the lead agency. So obviously in the case of COVID, that's DOHMH. And then DSS is also usually involved in the beginning just because they're a big agency, and then others as needed. But what we try to do is right away figure out what are the language access challenges. Does the lead agency have the resources they need? What are the language access challenges the lead agency may be experiencing? And how can we coordinate our resources? So a few of the initial things we did in that task force back in March was, you know, obviously check in with DOHMH. How's your vendor? Are they, you know, giving you translations in the turnaround time that you need? Do you need support of any other agencies in terms of language services? We decided to expand the number of languages to 25 languages that DOHMH materials would be translated into. We knew there was a challenge with quickly disseminating multilingual content. And so we, determined how can we support agencies who need quick turnaround, whose own contracts aren't providing the fast turnaround that the situation demands. And so we had a few pro bono resources come our way. We figured out internally who should coordinate those resources. MOIA wound up coordinating those resources, and we were able to offer some pro bono services to agencies so that they could get faster turnaround. And the Language Access Task Force is just one piece, right? There's still, outside of the task force, MOIA is still working with all agencies. And in touch with language access coordinators and fielding requests from agencies. You know, we expanded our language services contract so that they could accommodate the needs of other agencies as well.
And just as a side note or a connection to some of the other questions, that contract that you just spoke to right now, is that still part of the 5 to 10 million increase of the larger?
No, so that's a good question. Yeah, that's an addition.
An addition. Okay, it'd be great to work with you on the in a more kind of direct way to kind of get a sense of what we're talking about, because I think what this hearing is really showing is that there's a lot of infrastructure here, and we're really trying to understand what's keeping us from filling the gap that this hearing started with. And. And so a couple more questions about this task force, because I think it's interesting, or a question that can help illuminate some of the issues. Are the needs of a single LEP language population considered enough for the task force to activate? So one single LEP community.
I mean, we've seen that with like I think in your district, right, with a fire in a residence, it was mostly Chinese language speakers who needed additional support, and we activated the task force for that, right? So we have definitely seen various instances where it's really one focused language. Very often we'll work with not just the lead response agency, but our office in community affairs in those instances too, to ensure, I think, again, speaking to some of the best practice that the first panel spoke about, just the relational and cultural competency response, particularly in emergency where people are rightly upset and aggrieved, and that is really an important part of the language access work as well.
And thank you for that. I remember that, and that was a really beautiful partnership that got a lot of people connected to services, especially with the housing piece. That was not easy and that was a long commitment, really, at the end of the day. So thank you for that. This is another kind of angle to the same question and idea. If just one agency's capacity to respond to a situation in language, in the language that is required, is overwhelmed, if they are overwhelmed, would the language access task force be activated? So there's an agency, they're trying and they can't get it. Would that trigger?
Go ahead, Bita.
No, I was gonna ask for clarification of the question. So if you've got it, go.
I think I understand the question. So it's more when the lead agency, so, you know, NYCM has all these playbooks and they assign lead agencies for various emergencies. So, you know, DSS is the lead agency for disaster service centers, you know, in the aftermath of a hurricane, if there's a disaster assistance service center, DSS is lead, DOH is lead in this case. So if the language needs are greater than the lead agency's capacity, that is one of the triggers. So I don't know if that totally answers your question.
We want to get a sense of this, because we're obviously moving towards the direction to build out this system. And so we're trying to figure out what causes a moment where there is extra support, and whether it's a language, whether it's an agency that's over capacity, and really how to work with you to figure out how we can offer resources. How do we resource? And you've heard about the language bank. And maybe this is an opportunity to talk a little bit about your support for the language bank and what that might be for this larger conversation.
Sure, I can start. We did, I think, as the panel noted, we did meet with the panel, I think, last year around the budget process to understand the proposals and to kind of wrap our heads around whether or not they aligned with our thinking or whether we had questions. I do think Aracelis, I believe, noted some of the questions that we have, right, about scalability, about how it would work or partner with different agencies, about responsiveness to sort of what we're seeing or trying to focus on, not diminishing kind of the added value. We did, in the aftermath of that, those conversations, continue some efforts that we'd already begun but added onto, and just conversations with some of the lead organizations that have been doing the cooperative development, conversations with SBS on that as the lead contracting agency. We had conversations with interpretation cooperatives that unfortunately announced their closure, like Catacol, during the pandemic, and as well as actually some international organizations that we knew did cooperatives. And then separately, we've talked to the city of DC to understand their bank. And I think, so we've been doing some work to inform our own thinking and position around it. But I think that there's probably still more to do in thinking through the model.
Would you commit to sitting down with myself and the committee and the advocates again, really in preparation for the January plan, as we get the better sense about what we're, actually, we haven't even gotten to the November plan. So let's be real about that. But I think in the spirit of alignment here, would you commit to sitting down with us and really kind of looking at that together?
Sure.
Wonderful. Thank you for that. And the last question is about the Notify NYC COVID-19 messages that people are getting in real time. These are text messages, kind of pointing to one of them. They're only available in English and Spanish. And so are there conversations right now that are pointing to adding additional languages and support for those specific text messages?
So they're also available in Chinese. You have to, the sort of how to sign up for them, it looks different, but that's still something that's available. And we, you know, that was an addition, that's part of the sort of building out the infrastructure conversation that we've had. This, along with the questions that we raised around website and 311, these are sort of areas that we've started a working group with DoIt around. And as I said, we have begun our focus on the 311 complaint system and the website accessibility, and we're looking at the others as well.
Got it. Okay. And so I have some follow-ups, actually. The HPD, the agency, HPD, states that their language access plan relies on NYC Volunteer Language Bank. Do you know about this? Yeah.
We know what the language bank is.
At HPD?
We have a centralized volunteer language bank. It is not the first place, I should say, that agencies should go, right? Everybody has to have the vendor contracts. The bank is an additional support for folks, and maybe you can talk about its utilization, but that predates Local Law 30 and is an infrastructure that we have trained agencies around.
Okay, a little bit more about how it works, because it looks to us when we read it that HPD, it's HPD's, and it sounds like you're saying that it's a different piece, auxiliary support for HPD that you all manage.
There's a volunteer language bank, and city staff from all city agencies can enroll if they want and use their bilingual skills. We advise agencies that this resource be used, for example, for translation review, but that agencies get contracts with professional vendors. My understanding is that HPD does have the requisite contracts. They have telephonic interpretation. They have a contract with a translation vendor. They have in-person interpretation vendor. So I'd have to check that specifically again, but my understanding is that they have the vendors and use those primarily.
And they may be using the language bank for that secondary review or third review, but we would have to double check.
Got it. Yeah, that's really curious. I would love to kind of learn more about how that works and what agencies are utilizing it that may not have reported that they're using it, and just seeing where the flow of energy is going to city agencies and why they're using it. Okay, I think this is the last one. I think this is the last one for me. Okay, SPS. At first, SPS did not share information about the city's small business loan program, except for English. So first it was just in English. And unfortunately, as a result of the delay in publication of that information on digital platforms, et cetera, to LEP populations, many LEP business owners were unable to access the urgent assistance. SPS's own language access plan states that it incorporated an emergency preparedness plan to ensure that LEP customers are able to access the language service during an emergency. But it's not clear if and where that plan exists and whether it was implemented. So if you can kind of talk a little bit about that, and I don't know if you've worked with them on that since that moment happened less than a year ago.
Yeah, I can start and you can jump in. I think, yes, we were made aware, and certainly ourselves saw that there was not adequate accessibility on the release of those opportunities. We worked really closely with SBS in the aftermath of that to address this as new resources were coming on board, and that as we were pushing them out, that included a few different things that we did. One is we devoted some of our language service capacity to support them, particularly around sort of, I think at the time when the next sort of payroll protection program came out and was being administered, we also worked to provide added capacity on virtual engagements in different languages. To support them and the development of graphics and the videos and all the measures that I previously talked about in different languages to help disseminate them. And we worked to ensure that as they kind of moved towards lifting up their hotline, right, that was something that was in place with the requisite interpretation services available. And anything you want to add by way of the plan or any corrective measures that we've taken with them since?
I mean, only that they've also made some improvements to their websites in terms of their website, in terms of accessibility. Yep. We worked with them on that. I think just in terms of the plan, you know, I think, the new plans are due June 2021. So we're going to be starting that process with agencies early next calendar year to revise their implementation plans. And I think this is an important part of the plan that we can focus on with agencies.
Thank you. And I'm sure a lot of small businesses would be incredibly thankful for that. And maybe with that, I'll just end with incredible gratitude for your time today and for all the promise that you've given us to sit down and just hammer some of these things out, work in coalition with our advocates on the ground. Thank you to the advocates that started the conversation and the public panel. Thank you for kind of laying out the foundation. And again, happy Thanksgiving to you and your family.
Thank you so much. Thanks for holding the hearing, and we look forward to this conversation.
Looking forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Seeing no other council member questions, we'll now be turning to we'll be concluding administration testimony and turning to public testimony. I'd like to remind everyone that we will be calling on individuals one by one to testify, and each panelist will be given 3 minutes to speak. For panelists, after I call your name, a member of our staff will unmute you. Please wait for a brief moment for the Sergeant at Arms to announce that you may begin before starting your testimony. Council members who have questions for a particular panelist should use the raise hand function in Zoom. I will call on you after the panel has completed their testimony in the order in which you have raised your hand. I would now like to welcome our first public panel. First, I will be calling on G. Hay Fisher to testify. After that, I will be calling on Ramatu Ahmed, followed by Alexandra Lee, followed by Halle Yi. G. Hay Fisher, you may begin when you are ready.
Starting time.
I would like to thank Chair Menchaca and Chair Cabrera and the members of the Committee on Immigration and Government Operation for the opportunity to testify. My name is G. Hay Fisher, and I am the Executive Director of the Korean American Family Service Center. We provide social services to the immigrant survivors and their children who are affected by domestic violence, sexual assault, and child abuse. All our programs and services are offered in a culturally and linguistically appropriate setting. 98% of our clients are immigrants, and 100% of our staff members are immigrants themselves or children of immigrant parents. Over 95% of our clients' first language is not English and come from low-income backgrounds. During New York State on pause and throughout the COVID-19 public health and economic crisis, KFSC responded to a 300% increase in calls to our 24-hour hotline. 88% were related to DV, domestic violence and sexual assault and child abuse. Between February and July 2020, KFSC served 915 individuals and provided 19,802 services related to domestic violence and sexual assault. Our frontline essential workers met the increased need and provided in-person crisis intervention, counseling, case management, and other supportive services, all in a culturally and linguistically appropriate setting. In addition to crisis intervention, the needs we're hearing directly from our serving populations are basic necessities such as ethnic food, groceries, and cleaning supplies, cash assistance, for medical expenses or rent subsidies. This dissemination and education around the latest COVID-19 virus information on public benefits such as unemployment, Medicare, small loan opportunities, and accessing healthcare, as most of our clients are uninsured. Inquiries of counseling sessions with various family violence issues. As mentioned above, many of our clients and their children are trapped at home with abusers or hidden family issues that have surfaced as all members of the family are clustered in a small space. Our immigrant survivors were disproportionately impacted and further traumatized by policies and responses that excluded them from emergency relief efforts. Many of our survivors are undocumented and are excluded from accessing unemployment insurance and all other income supports. They lost financial means, some temporarily, others permanently, resulting in loss of livelihood and unable to support themselves and their children. These consequences are exacerbated as they are ineligible for unemployment benefits and other labor protections by law from which they are excluded. Many in our community and their loved ones have contracted the virus and died. Without financial means, our immigrant survivors can afford food, rent, basic necessities, personal protective equipment and supplies, Medicare, or basic living expenses. Current policies do not account for immigrant workers who lost their legal employment status as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. These gaps result in uncertainty and fear of deportation as another hurdle to overcome in an already overwhelming and desperate situation. Furthermore, our immigrant families were affected with the shift to remote learning. When schools closed in March, our Hodoi after-school teachers spent extra hours to bridge the digital gap. Many of our families have multiple children, majority did not then, and so do not have the adequate number of digital devices for virtual school. Challenges due to limited English proficiencies already increased existing issues due to family violence at home, poverty, and cultural differences. Particularly the COVID-19 pandemic and subsequent closings of schools and business highlighted these gaps even further. Thank you again for this opportunity to testify. And I thank you for your time again.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Ramatu Ahmed to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Thank you very much for inviting me. My name is Ramatu Ahmed, and I am the founder of the African Life Center, serving the African community in the Bronx and other boroughs in the city. The African community, as we all know, is an immigrant community. We have a lot of issues, but I'm targeting my presentation on housing for my testimony. It is an honor to testify on housing for the African community. And the housing issues, among others, is the overbearing rent that most people can't afford. And I really care about housing because of safety, which is number one for every human being to live in harmony. It is also evident that housing as their permanent abode for people can contain the spread of the virus. And again, it's a testament as to what we are seeing now in our country. When people are assigned to a house, they are traced easily, and then when tested for COVID-19. So providing them with housing prevents also crimes from happening in the society. Unfortunately, information on housing doesn't get to the African community, those with the information, those Africans or people who have the information, they also lack the skills to access the services. For instance, filling out the application. And when I received invitation to testify on behalf of the African community, I sampled community members and asked them questions about their experiences applying for housing. And I had stories from first and second parties on efforts they encountered in applying, but all to no avail. Some do ask their children to fill out the application, but they also fail to do so. They fail to get the positive result. So Some also complain they apply, but are always told to, they will be called, and it never happened. For using Housing Connect to access housing, I mean, it is also difficult for most of them, but also stressful for people with English as a second language, and again, for seniors. Programs like Housing Connect Ambassador Program don't have African organizations contracted to organize rent and financial counseling to the community members. So I want to line up the challenges. Number one, the Housing Connect Program Ambassador Program is not felt in the African community. There is also difficulty locating apartments from 1 to 4 bedrooms. Navigating Housing Connect becomes cumbersome for most people. And again, selected candidates for housing end up not eligible. Most issues are related to their income or after the interview.
Time expired.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Alexandra Lee to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good afternoon. On behalf of OCA New York, I would like to thank the Immigration Committee Chairs, Council Members Menchaca and Council Member Cabrera, and the committee members providing this time to speak on the issue of language access in New York City. OCA, Asian Pacific American Advocates, is a national nonprofit civil rights org promoting and protecting the political, economic, and cultural rights of Asian Americans in the United States. Founded in 1973, the organization has grown to over 50 chapters and affiliates around the country, working with organizational partners and members on policy issues affecting the AAPI community, such as immigration, racial equality, inclusion, and civic engagement. The New York chapter has been especially active in census participation efforts, Get Out the Vote, hate crimes prevention, and in conjunction with the Black Lives Matter movement. A lot of our testimony mirrors the Asian American Federation's testimony, so I don't wanna be sort of repetitive, and we're happy to submit our written testimony at the end. The issue of language access directly impacts New York City and New York City's Asian American population. New York City is home to nearly 1.2 million documented and undocumented Asian Americans, representing more than 13% of the city's total population. New York City's Asian community is tremendously diverse, comprising of individuals representing more than 20 countries and 45 languages and dialects. Many of New York City's Asian American population experience high rates of limited English proficiency and other language barriers when accessing New York City's services. In a time when federal policy directly impacts the immigration population, giving preference to those with English language proficiency, for example, in the public charge issue, or the proposal to instate a more complicated U.S. citizenship exam, language access is a necessity for our community. Whether it's securing justice for crime victims, protection for domestic violence and intimate partner violence victims, or access to health services and healthcare, there is an urgent need for language access for the LEP community to be able to understand and communicate effectively in this dynamic, especially now with the COVID pandemic. The issue of language access has really heightened and exacerbated the problem of how the lack of language services impacts the immigrant population of New York, the Asian American population, and the limited English proficiency population as a whole. I just want to give my two cents of my personal position as an immigration attorney and criminal defense attorney. We see the issue of language access
Time expired.
Being a very serious problem in the access to justice. There are limited translation services within the legal justice system, and especially during this time, during the COVID pandemic, it's even more of a challenge. Everything has gone to sort of these telephonic and virtual services, and it's very challenging. It's of course, impacted folks with limited resources that don't have the access to technology to access these services. So with that, OCA New York and myself personally, we encourage the City Council to work with CBOs and organizational partners providing language access for the limited English proficiency community, especially during this unprecedented time during the COVID pandemic. Thank you for this time.
Thank you, Ms. Lee.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Hallie Yee to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good afternoon. My name is Hallie Yee, and I'm policy coordinator at the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families. Thank you, Chairman Chaka and Cabrera and members of the committees for giving us this opportunity to testify. Since 1986, CACF has been the nation's only Pan-Asian children and families advocacy organization that leads the fight for improved and equitable policies, systems, funding, and services to support those in need. We speak on behalf of our highly immigrant Asian American communities today who have been left behind in the city's COVID response and must be centered in discussion of revitalization as they face greater challenges and loss due to this pandemic. Immigrant New Yorkers have been at the forefront of the state's fight against COVID, representing one third of the state's essential workers and playing a key role in all sectors of our battle against the pandemic, from food production and delivery to construction and frontline healthcare provision. This ongoing exposure has contributed to the disparate outcomes, COVID-19 infection death and death, which have disproportionately afflicted immigrant communities of color. On behalf of our 40 plus organizational partners and members, we have been asking City Council to hold our public health systems accountable to our community's needs through three key steps. First, that the city provide accurate data collection and disaggregation of data on infection rates, hospitalizations, and deaths in the APA community. Second, that the city address mental health needs of children and families, especially those East Asian presenting who have been targeted during this pandemic. And third, that the city's health system can ensure that critical information gets to families in the language they need. Of these, of course, today we will be focusing on the latter, as Asian Americans have the highest rate of linguistic isolation of any group in the city at 42%, with no one over the age of 14 in that house speaking English well, and 78% of our community being foreign-born. COVID-19 has highlighted the barriers the most marginalized Asian Americans face to language access. The mere availability of languages is not enough without effective outreach and implementation of language access policies, preventing vital communication about school decisions and the pandemic from reaching the community. The delay of disseminating and general lack of in-language information about the pandemic, including the social distancing guidelines, has led to a higher risk of exposure to the virus for the most vulnerable in our community. This egregious gap in language access has led to our communities to rely once again upon the community-based organizations who serve them in the absence of proper resources by the city, as CBOs continue to act as interpreters and crowdsource translated materials regarding even the most basic of information on the pandemic. Outreach to the most marginalized pockets of the community must be prioritized. Without it, their health and very lives are endangered if they are unable to communicate with their healthcare providers, their schools, and city agencies. Our communities are consistently overlooked in the distribution of resources, which is harmful to us, as well as other communities of color who are denied the same resources due to the perceived success of APAs. This pandemic has highlighted a myriad of holes in our city's safety net system, and the city's response must address root problems in addition to immediate needs. Our community will continue to suffer every day we allow these flaws to exist in the system. As always, CACF will continue to be available as a resource and partner to address these concerns.
Time expired.
I look forward to working with you to better address our community's needs. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I will now turn it over to Chairman Chaka for any questions.
Thank you for this panel and the really kind of drill down of experiences that we're hearing from many New Yorkers who are not connecting to vital services, everything from housing and the affordable housing application process is already hard in one language. Of course, it's going to be even more difficult to do in multiple languages, but it's imperative that it happens because any access that our New Yorkers don't have is a detriment to a person's life. And so all of these things are just so important, not just to listen to, but to put on the record. And so you heard from the administration that they're going to sit down with us and talk through some of that. And so let's keep doing that work together. And I want to just say thank you and I hope you have a good and safe Thanksgiving weekend.
Thank you, Chair. Seeing no other council member questions, we will be moving on to our next public panel. I'd like to now welcome Angelica Lara to testify. After Angelica Lara, we will be hearing from Anna Guiltanda. Angelica Lara, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Angelica Lara, and I am the Education and Outreach Director at UnLocal. UnLocal is a community-centered nonprofit organization that provides direct communication, community education, outreach, and legal representation to New York City's undocumented immigrant communities. Since going remote in March, our education and outreach team has hosted 47 remote outreach events on immigration policy changes and enforcement, COVID-19-related information, the census, and how to protect your rights. We have deep connections with New York City's immigrant communities and partnerships with over 140 community-based organizations and schools. Our legal team handles complicated immigration matters for immigrants from Latin America, Africa, the Middle East, Asia, Europe, and the Caribbean. The majority of our clients are Black, Indigenous, people of color, and have limited English proficiency. We welcome this opportunity to address the issue of language access and how it impacts the delivery of emergency preparedness information for immigrant New Yorkers. UnLocal relies on the speed, accuracy, and availability of translations of materials and updates created by New York City agencies, as we are routinely disseminating their information to the public. During COVID, updates in accessible languages are a top priority for our community members. We are grateful for our partnership with Moya for the past 2 years that enables us to provide its Know Your Rights presentation materials to the public. We are hopeful that going forward, any policy updates to these materials will be translated into languages other than English before they are released to enable our teams to deliver the information as quickly and efficiently as possible to immigrant communities. We urge the city to expand its languages accesses to resources to include the translation of materials into indigenous languages. As COVID relief programs develop, we continue to see the undocumented people are left out despite the fact that so many of them make up New York's essential workforce. Rent relief must be expanded and extended. Small business grants must be revamped and made accessible to immigrant business owners. All webinars must be held in such a way that makes them accessible to those who speak languages other than English. Not having access to resources and information that you can understand has a profoundly negative impact on people's well-being, and it has a direct correlation to health, housing stability, food access, and mental health. To be able to truly call ourselves a sanctuary city, we must provide accessible information to our immigrant communities and include them in our emergency preparedness planning process, both as decision makers and beneficiaries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Anna Guiltanda to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good afternoon. My name is Anna Guiltanda, staff attorney in the Family and Immigration Unit in Legal Services New York City. Legal Services New York City's advocacy for the past decade has led to language access improvements with the NYPD, NYCHA, and New York courts. About Local Law 30, although city agencies have made efforts to implement it, they are not sharing essential information in effective and meaningful ways. In many instances, immigrants cannot access the information, including emergency preparedness plans during COVID-19 due to technological and digital barriers. This leaves immigrant communities in the dark and unprotected during a time when they most need to access city services. It is our clients who bear the brunt of city agencies' failure to meaningfully comply with Local Law 30. Many of our clients could not find COVID-19 testing sites using the city's websites. Many families with young children did not know how to sign up for SNAP benefits and did not know which schools were providing grab-and-go meals. Others cannot pay rent because of loss of income and continue to struggle under the weight of rental arrears. This is made worse because they cannot navigate the HRA website. One client recently divorced and has no financial support. She struggled to get HRA benefits and the agency did not translate information into Bengali for her, even though it is a covered language under Local Law 30. We have the following recommendations. First, we urge city agencies to use Executive Order 47 to provide essential information to LEP communities by using ethnic media platforms that specifically cater to those communities. Second, agencies must provide essential information to LEP individuals in creative ways. For instance, agencies should use informational videos and short tutorials that LEP individuals can easily access and share in multiple platforms. Third, agencies should also consider the use of social media platforms and networking sites commonly used by LEP individuals, such as WeChat and WhatsApp, to effectively convey essential information. Fourth, city agencies must create emergency preparedness and response plans, implement them meaningfully and promptly in emergency circumstances, and make them accessible to LEP individuals in at least the 10 designated city languages. Thank you to the committees for providing us with an opportunity to testify today.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now turn it over to Councilmember Menchaca for any questions.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you both for being here today, and really with more recommendations that are going to be part of how we engage the city in the next few months as we both look at resources, i.e. putting something in the budget, and a new strategy that looks at local or executive orders. And you just gave us some interesting executive orders to really push other opportunities and operational requests from the city to support our essential workers and our immigrants. And I think maybe what maybe I'll ask this question, because we're at the end and we've all been listening to a lot of information, and I still feel like the advocates need to be driving the policy that ends up being implemented, because it's not whatever the city's doing right now, it's just not working. And there's a lot of resources that are being put into it, time, effort, all this communication and task force, and how do we make it simple? And I think that would you all commit to sitting down with us and really creating this action plan? This action plan that may include some executive orders. I don't know how amenable the mayor's office is going to, or the mayor is going to be, to putting in an executive order in. The budget's going to be a negotiation. All these pieces are still unclear, but what can't be unclear is what's going to actually work. That has to be clear, because if that's not clear, then it's going to get lost. And we can't afford that to get lost. Will you commit to being part of this conversation?
Yes, we definitely commit to being part of the conversation.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you. Happy thanks. Is this the full panel, Harbani?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you to this panel. Happy Thanksgiving. I hope it's safe and that you are taking all the precautions, but enjoying yourselves and all the gratitude. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. At this point, we have concluded public testimony. If we have inadvertently missed anyone that is registered to testify today and has yet to be called, please use the Zoom raise hand function now, and you will be called on in the order that your hand has been raised. Seeing no hands, I'm going to turn it back to Chairman Chaka for closing remarks.
Well, I want to thank everyone for being here today, our Chair Cabrera and I, and all the members of the committee who were here to listen to the testimony of our first public panel, hear some responses from the Moya, the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs, and other city agencies, and their commitment to sit down with us and figure this out. We are not looking for a sense of compliance for the sake of compliance. What we're looking for is a transformation about a city who is a sanctuary, who is struggling to become a sanctuary city, let's be real, can actually put the resources and effort and strategy so that we can solve these issues that in the time of COVID and economic downturn is critical for the livelihood of this city. And I keep saying this over and over again under so many other pieces of legislation that we need to pass in the city, that the economy of the city of New York is an immigrant economy. And that economy has families that are connected to it, and education resources that are needed, and food and hunger issues and health and all these things that are really important that the city has for its New Yorkers And when it's not accessible, that is unacceptable in the deepest kind of way as a municipal service organization like the City of New York. So we need to solve that. I will say the following thing is more of an ask. The city last year was confronted with a budget crisis, and the city council members were we did our best, and we know that it wasn't good enough. And so maybe we can offer some ideas on how to think about funding this series of initiatives that can actually solve the problems and really build a people's budget, a budget that comes from all of you who understand what needs to happen and really bring that to us in the clearest way. And that's the work that we'll do right after this hearing is over. We'll follow up and let's start to work. Thank you to my staff.
Chairman Tuck, I'm sorry to interrupt. We have one person who did raise their hand. Okay. I'd like to quickly call on Cindy Lang to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Thank you.
I'm starting now.
Hi, thank you. My name is, because Cindy left her and she left with me. My name is Mizeda Udin from the co-founder. Hi, Carlos. How are you?
Good. Good to see you. Thank you for being here today.
Long time.
Yes.
We are very proud about you. You are with us always from the beginning to last.
Thank you. Thank you.
You are immigrants. And the reason I'm here today, Cindy left because it took so long time. Cindy gave it to me and said that, can I send my testimony or otherwise you can say a couple of words. And can I testify? It is to a very serious issue.
Yes, please.
Entire South Asian community. And it is very lacking that we are not getting as fun now as the immigrants. We are not treating oil as fun now. In the city pandemic times, still, that is a serious issue. And I can testify now. And my name is Mizeda Udin. I'm volunteer from the, so I am the co-founder of the South Asian Fund for Education, Scholarship, and Training. The service we are providing immigrants needs since 2015, we have delivered comprehensive array services to thousands of immigrants, children, youth, and adults. And there are Pakistan, Afghanistan, Maldives, Bhutan, India, and all South Asian communities in the New York City area. Thank you for giving me opportunity to speak about our language access issue that many, many of them are South Asian families facing today. As a SAFESTA representatives, my team have first-hand understanding challenging that our community face on a daily basis. Since the start COVID-19, many of our South Asian communities have lost their battle due to the reasons such as overcrowding, apartments shared by multi-generation, and the lack of information on how to protect themselves against the virus. Many of our South Asian students have suffered inequality in education because of their parents speak little or no English or could not help them their homework or schoolwork. And moreover, due to the lack of job security or lack of income, many mostly women and children have been suffering from their mental depression and physical abuse, but silently. Since March, SAFEST has worked overtime to help the community dealing with the losses of income, including assistant funeral arrangement and that finding shelters to better women and the children. But we feel that New York could do more bringing that language barrier gap for our communities. Here are the least issue our immigrant communities encounter. MTA billboard sign. In the beginning of COVID-19 pandemic, the MTA posted sign to remind people the proper way to protect themselves or a mask. While we appreciate MCA's effort to inform Bengali speaking riders, some of the right signs are translated incorrectly and created confusion to the riders. This is one confusion. After several communication with the Corey Johnson office, city council office, and the David Offren Assemblyman office, finally Corey Johnson solved that problem. MTA has to be or whenever any language translated, in especially in Bengali. I represent highest ranking of Bengali community in the New York state and city level. If any of the problem translating, please, safest organization is voluntarily to solve and review that translation before you publish, before you transfer, before you written signboard anywhere, even board of election, even board of ed, even board of in the community MTA transition. That is one problem. Then another problem, answering the 911 issue. That 311 issue. Since the start COVID-19 pandemic, Safest has made numerous 311 calls to request get food near city emergency home food delivery on behalf of community members. That they are our most vulnerable population in our community. They are the ones who cannot go to or make a call outside, have no one to can help them to get the food. And I call them personally. I call them because they could not speak English. They could not understand what number they can dial to get their proper language. Then I help them over 300 people to call them. Every time when I call the 311, said then, ma'am, why you keep calling? And I said that they could not speak English. I need to help them to get the food. And they said, no, tell them to call. Then a couple of people, I told them to call. They said that we cannot call because English is speaking. Then I call them, keep calling. Those are the people are not getting their food because I using my personal money to buy different SIM card, food that my phone line. Then I call them 311, get their food. And this is one issue. And then another issue is 911. I were two of the victims. One is a Brooklyn, one is a Bronx, one is a Jamaica Hills. One of the victims called for domestic victims. She called from the Bronx home to get her help for 911. When she called her husband next to her to listening everything, then when she started working, her husband took the phone from her. She could not get help, but 911 did not call back her. One. Then another in the Queens is happened that I can cry now. And then another incident happened in Jamaica here. So she called 911, but she tried to speak broken language. 911 did not give her a translator. 911 even did not call back to her. Finally, I put him a shelter in Yankar, put up, because New York City does not have enough space for the women's shelter is a DB victim. No, this is another serious issue. Then another issue is DOE, the Board of Ed. This is serious issue. Everybody has to put full attention on this DOE. Because this is education system. If our education system is broken, that means we are not belong to in this country. No education, no future. Number one problem is DOE submit wrong translation in their website. Many times I try to reach them to solve this problem is voluntarily to correct the language. Review the language. Even they send EVT card. There is no written Bengali translation is there. How to connect, how to call, where to get the help. I told different people call me and to help them by language, because personal information they cannot share with anyone, even though I call. Okay, every phone number is saved everywhere. Okay, especially my number, Carlos, you know me better. Okay, then I try to use different SIM card by the different people in front of them. It is COVID-19. I could not reach everyone to get their help. Then another issue is laptop issue. Another issue is iPod issue. These are has to be somehow getting help from the bilingual, especially LAP problem. I am also interpreter in your city. Different department, housing, board of ed, judicial panel, everywhere I am the representative from the my language. And many way our people are suffering by for their right help, right get. Even so many people are corrupted somehow because of bilingual problem. Even they are bullied from that false attorney. They are corrupt by misguided false direction. Those are the things has to be corrected. And that iPad, so many students is not getting iPad yet. They are missing their homework. They are not getting their proper direction. Even internet service is so poor. All of a sudden, some of the students are working with the remote program to the children. They could not even take the next class. They could not even finish what teachers say. Even parents could not help because of LAP. They could not even go to the people's first account, how to go to the account to check whether children is doing great or keep failing to the student. I am getting from my home every day, 7 to 12 phone to missing the homework. Child is not connecting with the children. Child is not finishing their homework. Because of LAP problem, they could not solve this problem. Those parents are begging to the teacher, helping from the teachers to help to parents guide. But because of LAP, because of today, I picked up 7 call, 5 of them missing homework. And that missing homework and parent is begging me, I am an interpreter, begging me to tell them I can be on the line while teacher is helping to the children. That has to be solved. And then another problem, another request I'm getting, while children are doing the homework rather than they are playing the video games, not to finish the homework. How do they control the parental some way? They have to control while they are student in their remote program.
Wow.
This issue has to be solved.
Yes.
Anyhow, that school from the DOE has to be giving them laptop to blocking any other website, only the school facility while they are in students, while they are in ruining the remote class. That has to be taken care of this. Otherwise, children are keep failing. Children are not getting help from the teacher because most of them, our teacher are not our Bengali. Mm. Most of the teacher is not our bilingual. And that needs to be help from our minority children. This is serious issue. Our New York City education system falling apart. Let me tell you, we have to stand up. I think, Carlos, you are immigrants and you understand what our immigrants value. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Udine, for this incredible testimony that you have brought from the community. And so much of it you're holding. And so I just want to say thank you for holding that. That is a lot to hold for one person. But I know that you are doing everything you can right now to support our young people, our parents in education, in hunger, and in 911 calls and domestic violence. These are all things that the city is ready to support our communities. And what you're exposing is the fact that this system breaks down and people are left behind. And that is wrong. And so We want to follow up with you, so make sure that our team has all of your information, because I want to sit down with you and really look at some of the things that could be solved immediately. And some of those things are going to be more structure issues, like the Department of Education issue with a translator being on the phone with homework help. And if they're not allowing that to happen, we've got to look at how to solve that issue. And it sounds like there are other, I see some Zoom nods that people are saying, yeah, that's an issue. We need to solve that. And the way we solve that is by talking about it and bringing voice to it. And you did that today. And so I want to say thank you for that. And so with that, just make sure that you leave all your contact information so that our team can follow up and really say thank you. I'm glad that you said that you signed up and you spoke today. It makes me feel good. And we're going to work on this together.
Thank you, Carlos. Your help is most helpful. And my office trying their hard job, DOE trying to hard job, but someone has to be spoken up. Someone has to bring this issue to the table so that our children can, you know, anyhow, I sleep almost every day around 2 a.m. because I try to help to on the one time to the parents to guide how to go to that people's account, how to go to the Zoom. Parent doesn't know how to use the Zoom. That is another problem, okay? And because of a language barrier. And then another thing, today, 5 of the parents said that they don't know what their children is doing, whether they finished the homework, whether they're playing the video games, whether they did not finish, even some of the children is hiding themselves, not to show the parents how children understand that they are doing finish. And one parent just told me a couple of minutes ago, said that every day I saw him on the computer, but I don't know what he's doing.
Yeah.
You understand? Because of LAP, language barrier, education level, that has to be solved. But thank you for giving me opportunity to come here today to spoke out. And this issue is serious issue. Somehow, I think we need to be clear. We are planning to at least volunteer community service to involve with the school policy to giving opportunity to voluntarily we can help to the parents to finish the homework, involve with the children. I think that will be grateful for that. And I am very glad I am here today. And I think I should be involved with the mayor office to immigrant advisory board, advocacy board, so that I can bring an issue to the table so that I can solve individually or to create a volunteer teams to parents guide.
I love that idea. And I'm going to support that. And I think everybody who showed up at this hearing today, I want to send a message to all of you to let's convene. And I don't know if you know Aracelis in the Bronx and Alexandra Lee, who's here as well, listening to you, giving us a lot of feedback with their head nodding and saying, yeah, they're in solidarity with you, that we're gonna do this together. And so thank you again for your time today, for spending that time. And I know that there is a Thanksgiving holiday, and let us move into that holiday with a sense of gratitude for each other and the partnership that we have here to make some big changes in our city that are necessary.
Thank you. Together we can help and build community. Thank you.
We're gonna do everything we can.
Thank you. See you again.
And with that, I'm going to close this hearing.